Ladies and gentlemen, if you'd please take your seats, we'll begin in 5 minutes. Ladies and gentlemen, if you'd please take your seats, we'll begin in 5 minutes.
Good morning, everyone. Please take your seats and we'll begin shortly. Good morning, everyone. Thank you for coming. My name is Ziad Burkett, and I am a multi-Mises U alumnus. I've been to Mises U 3 times, which is, you would think, 2 times more than the average person, but surprisingly, people go quite often, and for good reason. It's an amazing time, it's an amazing event, and I'm gonna tell you just very briefly about what the Mises Institute has done for me. It's really just transformed the way, you know, you look at the world. You know, when you understand economics and libertarianism, as many people say, once you read Rothbard, you never look at the world the same way again. And in addition to learning proper economics, as Mises himself said, you know, it was a great task incumbent upon everyone, a task that, you know, we need to maintain the civilization that we have and love today. It's also helped me in my professional career as well, substantially. I recently started my own business, and we sell a pretty premium product, and it's a very unique task to sell a premium product. It's really helped us understand that we really need our product to be higher on the individual value scale of people than the dollars that, you know, they have to trade in transaction for it. And really, just that simple task really has encouraged us and forced us to really... It's really helped us to really understand all the values of our product, not just a couple little selling points, but really the whole solution, all of the features and benefits that our product has to offer really, really has made us tremendously more successful. And just that little task, I mean, I learned within, you know, a couple minutes in a couple articles in the Mises Institute. And, you know, later in college, I learned the same thing, but that took many months and many hundreds and thousands of dollars. And it's incredible what the Mises Institute can do with just a couple articles and a couple books, and that's just a very small percentage of what they have to offer. Many other things I've learned from the Mises Institute and being at Mises University for my business. It's been incredible, helpful for my career personally, professionally, really helping other people, you know, properly understand economics and libertarianism and the philosophy behind it. And I'm very grateful for it. So thank you all for coming. And to start the day off, we'll be having Congressman Thomas Massie up and President Jeff Dice. So, thank you very much.
Well, thank you very much for that, Ziad. And keep an eye on this young man. He's got a cold press juice business that I think is going to make him very wealthy someday. So I might need to keep his number. You know, it's interesting. We were just in this room a couple of years ago celebrating Ron's 80th birthday party. Had a band that day, and it was a great day. And it's nice to see a lot of you again down here in Lake Jackson, and not necessarily in Houston. Pat Barnett tells me this morning we have about 340 people here representing. I thought this was impressive. We have 25 states here today, so we're actually about half of the United States is represented, along with Australia, Israel, and Canada as well. So. Thanks so much to all of you for making time to join us this morning. Really honored by your presence, and I know Ron and Carol appreciate it very much, and we're so happy and honored and pleased that Congressman Massie and David Stockman could make time to be with us this morning. And of course, when we first planned this event last fall, I guess it was predictable perhaps that come April of next year, you know, the United States government would be bombing Syria. But what was perhaps not so predictable was that it would be Donald Trump doing it, because we thought at that point Hillary was going to win. And of course now we're at the 100th anniversary of Woodrow Wilson signing the Declaration of War for the United States to enter World War I. So we tend to recall that, but what we tend to forget is that it was only a year and a half later that the United States and the Allies signed the armistice. So this wars used to have an end to them, which I think is an interesting concept and something we've certainly lost. So watching TV yesterday, I always cringe when I hear the term foreign policy establishment or foreign policy community, because you know whoever's going to be the next guest is going to be somebody bad when you hear that. So I'm watching MSNBC Morning Joe, and Mika is smiling. She's the happiest she's been since Trump was elected. She's just ecstatic that the United States government is finally doing things, is doing robust things. And you know, when you hear about the foreign policy community, what that really means is they're going to trot out a guest you've seen many, many times before. So they've learned nothing from the Trump election. It's the same old people, the same old ideas, the same old thoughts. So they brought out General Barry McCaffrey. And McCaffrey starts waxing eloquent about the virtues of these Tomahawk missiles. You know, you can park a warship in international waters and send these missiles for hundreds, maybe thousands of miles, and they can hit a target the size of a garage door, et cetera, et cetera. So he's animated by this.
And then he continues, but, you know, our next task, the next step in this, is taking out the Syrian Air Force. And this, unlike just lobbing Tomahawk missiles, is actually going to require air power launched, in other words, fighter planes launched from U.S. naval vessels. So he goes on and on about how this is the next step. And it was incredible to me to listen to this, how these things just devolve, how one airstrike then leads to taking out the Syrian Air Force. There's no plan for any of this. There's no declaration of war. It's just something that sort of unrolls. And it seems so natural to McCaffrey that this should happen. And I think it has become natural for us. And when we think about foreign policy in the United States, we think about foreign policy intelligentsia, the so-called think tanks. For the most part, I don't think it's a stretch to say they've been captured. They've been captured by people with neoconservative foreign policy views, empire-building, nation-building views, imperialist views, and they've also been captured by the defense industry. That may sound like a bit of a cliche, but I think it's largely true. And that's why we're so pleased to partner today with the Ron Paul Institute for Peace and Prosperity, because really, from my perspective, they're the only organization in the United States, certainly, that's devoted to foreign policy from a purely non-interventionist perspective. In other words, from the perspective that non-interventionism ought to be an actual principle by which we conduct foreign policy rather than just a policy option. And by non-interventionism, I mean that absent a really compelling threat to the United States, that our country, our government, should not interfere militarily, clandestinely, economically, in the affairs of other countries. It's really just that simple. And this is the case, of course, that Ron Paul made for years and years in Congress. It's not isolationism. It's certainly not pacifism, although it's oftentimes painted that way. But of course, non-interventionism as a theory is based on the idea, the ancient idea of just war doctrine, that there ought to be some real interest served by going to war other than just a self-serving national interest. And I think we've reached the point now where the national interest of the United States can mean virtually anything. I mean, should you know, if a country is potentially going to have nuclear weapons 20 years hence or 30 years hence, is that a sufficient national interest for us to be engaging them militarily today? I think there's some people who would say yes to that question. But the Ron Paul Institute is really dedicated to the opposite perspective, that we should never interfere in the affairs of another country, absent a real justification. And of course, the Mises Institute, really since its inception with Lou Rockwell, has always been anti-war and pro non-intervention. It's really been part of our hallmark as an organization. Because I think if you understand economics, you very quickly understand that any country or government big enough to have an empire abroad is big enough to be burdensome and onerous at home, tyrannical at home even. I think the Mises Institute has always tried to make the case that there's a connection between central banks and war. There's a connection between the Fed and war finance. And of course, our namesake, Ludwig von Mises himself, fought as a lieutenant in World War I in the Austro-Hungarian army. He was actually the ripe old age of 32 when he entered that war, quite a bit older than many of his fellow soldiers, and had already written a major treatise on money. He was already a very accomplished thinker, legal expert, and an economist. And during that war, he writes in his memoirs that during some of his darkest moments in that war, he committed himself to writing another book afterwards about socialism, because he really viewed war as a socialist enterprise, and hence a nonsensical enterprise. And he gives a very interesting quote in his memoirs about war intelligentsia, the same people who plague us today. And I'm quoting Mises, he says, speaking of the Great War, World War I, the war came as a result of an ideology that had been proclaimed from German lecterns for hundreds of years. Professors of economics had contributed to the intellectual preparation for war. Sounds familiar. They did not first need to be retrained in order to become the intellectual bodyguards of the Hohenzollern. And here he's referring to the House of Hohenzollern, the German, Prussian, Romanian dynasty. He says, economics was no longer taught. What was taught were the doctrines of war. And I think that rings so true today. I guess we don't have monarchical dynasties anymore. I don't know what our houses are today. We have the House of Crystal, or the House of Northrop Grumman, or those are the only seeming dynasties in America anymore that just that come and go regardless of administrations. And of course, it was largely because of Ludwig von Mises that Ron Paul became Ron Paul. I'm sure a lot of you in this room know the story of Ron going to see Mises in the early 1970s at the University of Houston. And Ron came back from that talk really dedicated to the idea that he had to do something. He was a very happy and prosperous doctor at the time, but he felt that he wasn't doing enough, that he had to take the ideas that Mises was talking about and do something with them in his personal life. And of course, that led to him running for Congress where, and I think he will tell you that he really started off as more of an economic libertarian. And if he had just been willing to stay that way, if he had just been willing to sort of tamp down some of his beliefs in the foreign policy arena, he really could have been a darling of the conservative libertarian establishment. He could have been feted in Washington. He could have been made quite wealthy, received donations. But he would never do it. You know, he showed his non-interventionist credentials early on. Even when President Reagan called him and asked for his support for the B-1 bomber program. And here's Ron, a young congressman who had been one of the few Republicans to support Reagan's nomination in 76, one of only three or four Republicans at that time in the Texas delegation. He took that call from Reagan in his office. He said, no, I can't do it. And Ron continued to show his non-interventionist credentials when he signed his tremendous resignation letter to the RNC in 1987 and said, I can't be a Republican any longer. And he showed it when he ran for president in 1988, the Libertarian Party platform, where he insisted on having foreign policy as a key part of his campaign message. He certainly showed it on October 10th, 2002, when he was one of only six Republicans to vote against the Iraq War authorization. He showed it in 2008 in his now infamous Giuliani moment in the debates on, I guess that was Fox News. And he certainly showed it in 2012 when, as Carol Paul mentioned this last night, he was in South Carolina at a Republican primary debate and brought up the Golden Rule as a model for how Congress ought to conduct foreign policy and was resoundingly booed by the GOP primary voters in attendance. And of course, he showed it really continuously since leaving Congress, deciding to create the Ron Paul Institute and to go on all the major media talking head shows and have the audacity to question things like the Syrian gas attack a couple of days ago. And I think Ron deserves a lot of credit for really putting neoconservatism on its heels somewhat and playing a role in that sense in the revolution we've had, the anti-war revolution we've had in just the past couple of years, because there's an old adage in politics, if you're explaining, you're losing. And the neoconservatives have always had us explaining, and now it's time to turn the tables on them. Let's have them explain for a while why it's our job to remake the Middle East into Jeffersonian democracies, why it's our job to police the world, why it's our job to spend trillions of dollars on defense systems. And I think for the first time in a long time, the neoconservatives are forced to explain themselves, and I think that's a beautiful thing. So I'll leave you with this before we introduce our guest this morning. You know, way before I ever heard of Ron Paul as a young guy, for whatever reason, in our house, there was a copy of All Quiet on the Western Front laying around. And I happened to pick this up as a young guy, and I've probably read it 20 times. I read it just over and over again in my youth. And it's really one of the greatest anti-war books ever written, without trying to be. It's just a very honest assessment of a fictional assessment of a young soldier's life in World War I. But I've read it a couple times with my own son, who's now 13. And in this book, of course, we follow Paul Boehmer, who's only 19 when he first goes off to join the German army. And you know, full of vigor and convinced that Germany's in the right. And the opening scene in this book, he's with his buddies, Krupp and Mueller, and they go to see Kimmerich, who's in the hospital, who's been wounded and is doing very badly. And as they're standing around his hospital bed, it becomes quite obvious that Kimmerich is probably not going to survive through the night. And as much as they love him as their comrade in arms, they immediately start to eye his very shiny and still in good condition boots. And they start to ask themselves, what'll happen if we don't come back tonight Will the orderly take his boots? Who will get his boots? Will they fit me? And so already, just a year or so into the war, Paul Boehmer is starting to lose some of his humanity. He's forced to think more about his comrade's boots than his comrade's actual death, because this is the situation in which he's been put. So a lot of this book is really about how Paul Boehmer loses his youth and loses his innocence. And there's a very poignant scene where he comes home for leave, and just 2 years removed from his hometown, he can no longer relate to the townspeople because war has changed him so much. And what's interesting is we see this today when our soldiers come, when soldiers come back from Iraq and Afghanistan, we try to relate to them. His townspeople are still clueless about the war. They're still saying, well, you're just seeing the skirmishes you're in. You can't see the big picture. And, you know, we'll be on to Paris soon. And, of course, Germany at this point is badly losing. So I really recommend this book to just understand the sheer meaninglessness and the senselessness of war. I think it stands even today as one of the great anti-war books. And I'd like to just read you a quick passage of it that I love so much. This is his friend Krop talking. This is soldier talk when they're not at the front lines. He says, it's queer when one thinks about it, goes on Krop. We're here to protect our fatherland. And the French are over there to protect their fatherland. Now, who's in the right? Well, perhaps both, I say, without believing it. Yes, well, now, pursues Albert, I see that he means to drive me in a corner. But our professors and parsons and newspapers say that we are the only ones that are right. And let's hope so. But the French professors and parsons and newspapers say the right is on their side. Now, what about that? Well, that I don't know, I say. But whichever way is, there's a war all the same, and every month more countries coming in. He says, and then Jaden appears. He says, how does a war get started? Well, mostly by one country badly offending another, answers Albert with a slight air of superiority. And then Jaden pretends to be obtuse. A country? I don't follow. A mountain in Germany cannot offend a mountain in France, or a river, or a wood, or a field of wheat. He says, are you really just as stupid as that, or are you just pulling my leg, growls Krop. I don't mean that at all. One people offends the other. Then I haven't any business here at all, replies Jaden. I don't feel myself offended. So I've always remembered that passage from the book, and I've always enjoyed it so much. But, you know, since Congressman Paul left Congress, his impact on that institution remains, at least slightly, in the form of Thomas Massey and some other members of Congress. Now, Thomas Massey, like Ron, came to Congress a little differently, a little more circuitous route. He represents the 4th District of Kentucky, which I believe runs up close to the Ohio and Cincinnati and contains some of those suburbs. And I don't want to say all members of Congress, but unlike many members of Congress, Thomas Massey was smart. And he went to MIT and was an engineer there. And he actually created a company there while he was still a student, along with his wife, also an engineer. They had some very successful technology, which they later raised some venture capital for and sold. So he's been in the business world. He's certainly been in the tech world. He's an entrepreneurial thinker and a very storied engineer in his own right. But most importantly, for our purposes today, he's really, I would say, the most pro-liberty and pro-peace member of Congress who's carrying on Ron Paul's banner. And we're so grateful that he can make time for us today. So please, a warm welcome for Thomas Massey. It's up to you, 10, 15.
Well, you mentioned that I went to MIT, and that's where I took my first formal economics classes. And I took microeconomics. I absolutely loved it. But then I signed up for this macroeconomics class. And on the first day I went, and there was this young associate professor who gave us his office number and his office hours for the class. And it was only about 10 years later where I figured out why I hated macroeconomics at MIT. It's because the professor was Paul Krugman. So I didn't buy what he was selling when I was a sophomore at MIT, and I'm not buying it now. But that's not why I came here to speak. I came here to tell you about some things maybe you don't see in the news, maybe questions you have that only somebody in Congress could answer. The first one that I want to talk about is this notion that we've been notified, that, you know, oh, we notified Congress before we did this. Folks, I'm still waiting on my notification. The Russians were notified. I wasn't notified. So this notion that you could call the Speaker of the House and just say, hey, we're going to commit an act of war. You good with that? Oh, yeah, I'm good with that. The notion that that's notification of Congress is bad. It's false. And there are a lot of reasons why this should have come before Congress. The first of which is that's the only constitutional way to wage a war is the executive branch has to come to Congress to get that authority constitutionally. But there's a lot of other good practical reasons. Who's going to fund this damn war, right? Who's going to vote on those appropriations bills? Actually, they're going to be omnibus bills. It's going to be one giant 2,000-page bill that's got another $100 million to replace the stockpile of missiles from Raytheon that were expended 3 days ago. So that's the other good reason that you need to come to Congress. Somebody's going to have to write the check. And then I could go down the list. This seems like a movie that I've watched before in 2013. So literally the month that Ron Paul left Congress, I came into Congress. And not long thereafter, Obama said that Assad had crossed a red line, a bright red line, and that we had to attack Assad for using chemical weapons. And this was during the August time frame, September time frame. We came back from our August recess. Folks, there's only one issue that I've ever received more phone calls into my office in 4.5 years, more phone calls than the Obamacare light bill recently. And it was in 2013 when Obama said, let's go to war. And Boehner said, we're good with that. Pelosi said, we're good with that. And Obama said, and he was probably just hedging this because he knew it was not that popular and he wanted to cover his bases. It's not that he thought it was constitutional, the constitutional thing to do, or that he wanted to abide by the Constitution. Because in fact, he said, really, I think I've got the authority to do this, but I'm just to get your input, I'm going to come to Congress to get your buy-off. And what happened is, for about a week, this authorization for use of military force festered in Congress. The neocons thought that it was didn't go far enough. But really, the people that called my office, 100 phone calls a day, and that's a lot of phone calls. On average, I get about 10. 100 phone calls a day, 99 to 1. Actually, it was 100 to nothing in the first few days. And I went in the news and said, there's not a single person that called in favor of this war in Syria. This was in 2013. Well, then on the third day, we got a call. Somebody was in favor of it. And they said, well, why do you support it? He said, well, I heard the congressman say nobody was for it. So I thought somebody should call on the other side. So anyways, that was in 2013. And they never had the vote. They never took the vote. And here's why. Because it was so unpopular. And it would have failed miserably. And then Obama, he would have lost the mandate for what he did next. I mean, he never had a mandate, but he would have been prevented from what he did next, which is, according to the Washington Post, because I can't tell you what I know, but according to the Washington Post, we commenced to spending $1 billion a year on a secret war in Syria, funneling weapons and money to so-called moderate rebels. At $1 billion a year, that's going to leave a mark, okay, in a civil war. And but that's what, according to the Washington Post, has happened there. And it's not made things any better at all. I want to talk about some other areas of foreign policy, because I'm sure this will dominate today, the airstrikes in Syria. But Afghanistan, for instance, speaking of writing the check, who's going to write the check? We are writing checks hand over fist to prop up Afghanistan and rebuild their infrastructure. We have spent $100 billion, and this is according to the Inspector General, who's in charge of all of this, overseeing all of the money that's going into Afghanistan, John Sopko, Special Inspector General. Walter Jones and I have had him in hearings. We've had him in our office. And he's trying to blow the whistle on the waste, fraud, and abuse of all this money, even if you wanted to build Afghanistan's infrastructure. And we're on the hook, by the way, for another $10 billion. So this is going to be an interesting thing going forward. If this year does Trump ask us to quit spending money on the infrastructure in Afghanistan, because that doesn't seem like putting America first. But here's just an example of what some of that money goes to. We built a hydroelectric dam there. Now, there was a lot of talk about it getting blown up by the Taliban, and you never hear about that anymore. Do you wonder why the Taliban's not trying to blow up the hydroelectric dam anymore? They're getting the electricity. They get 30%. It's a deal that's been cut over there. We're paying the light bill for the Taliban now. They get, I think it's 30% of the electricity in exchange for not blowing it up or shooting the operators who are operating the dam. The war on drugs, in Afghanistan, we spent $8 billion on a war on drugs in Afghanistan alone, and they have doubled production of opium since we started spending $8 billion. And there's no results to show for it, even if you wanted results. I asked the Inspector General, I said, we got this stuff in Kentucky called Roundup. Could you spray that on those poppy plants? He said, yeah. I said, would it kill it? He said, oh, yeah, there's several herbicides that are very effective. I said, why don't we do that? He said, because it would be far too effective. It would decimate their crops. And then, again, you'd have the Taliban upset, and it would destabilize everything. Because, by the way, the Taliban used to prevent people from growing poppy. But now that we've degraded that country so much, I mean, that they now support it, and it's a source of their income. And so that's one of the reasons we don't take it out. Let me talk about another area of spending for war where we keep writing the check, and I hope Donald Trump looks at this. You know, we talk about all the Russian interference. Oh, my gosh, they're sending propaganda here, and it's causing our voters to go crazy and vote, you know, this way or that way. We have two programs. These are relics of the Cold War era, actually relics of World War II and before. Radio Free Europe and Voice of America, and then other versions of that in other countries. How much do you think we spend on that a year? This shocked me. On our own propaganda, state-run propaganda. I'm not talking about CNN. $750 million a year. And nobody in Congress is asking about that check, but they'll go on TV and castigate the Russians for spending money on getting their message out or on their propaganda. Let me tell you one of the solutions. So there are constitutionalists in Congress. There are people that have some major cognitive dissonance going on. They're writing the checks for this stuff that they know has these wars that have been started or waged unconstitutionally. And they want to abide by the Constitution. They ran on that platform. So behind closed doors, every week, we have a GOP conference meeting. And in that, there's no media. There's even our staff is not allowed in that meeting. Leadership staff is. So you hear some really interesting ideas there. One of them was proposed by a rigid constitutionalist, strong conservative. I'm not going to out him. But he was concerned that if Obama wanted to go to war with Iran, it would take us too long to decide. Yet he didn't want him to go to war with Iran without Congress's approval. His proposal was that we pre-declare war in the event that Obama ever decided, woke up one morning and decided that we should be in war. It would already be pre-declared. And this would save us the hassle and the time and the delays. So that's the kind of thinking that's going on. I mean, he wants to be constitutional, right? He realizes that's the clear text of the Constitution requires approval, but it doesn't say you can't just pre-approve it. So he wants to pre-approve it. I also had somebody get up last year in conference and slam the desk at the podium and say, we need more money for the military. We have been bombing so much for so long that our stockpiles are dangerously low. And I felt like I was in a cartoon. Like, our stockpiles are dangerously low. We've been bombing for so long. The stockpiles are dangerously low. We need to up the appropriations for the military. So anyways, these are the kind of things that you hear behind the curtain that I just wish were, you know, in public view. Very quickly, I want to talk about my concern. One of my concerns about this strike that we just had is that Donald Trump's poll numbers go back up. And because he is a, he's more than a populist. He's somebody that responds to popular opinion that day or in that group of 30,000 people who are clapping at what he says. And if the if he doesn't get booed pretty soon in one of those events with 30,000 people, either for supporting Obamacare Lite or for committing an act of war without congressional approval, if somebody doesn't boo him, he's going to think this is the right thing to do. And I don't know where the next strike would be. Maybe it would be in North Korea. And that concerns me gravely. So, in fact, if North Korea, if the government of North Korea were to lay down their arms tomorrow and just quit, they just walked away from it, you've got 25 million kept people, 25 million people that are basically almost all of them on the equivalent of Medicaid and food stamps, right? The South Korea is 50 million people. They don't want North Korea. They don't want to annex that, even if the government of North Korea left. I mean, it would be like East Germany and the European Union, or East Germany and West Germany on steroids, like multiply it times 100. We'd probably be asking the Chinese to feed North Korea if their government collapsed tomorrow. We wouldn't want to, some would want to pay that check. But anyways, that's a problem there. And so I hope that popular opinion does sway on this. By the way, people are, I would say our government in DC is guilty of a lack of imagination right now, and they always have been. So we can fully now grasp that that terrorists in the desert were able to commandeer four jets, commercial airliners, 19 people, take down both towers of the World Trade Center. They're that sophisticated, that far ahead thinking, to be able to do that. Yet it's beyond our imagination that somebody might have set something up in Syria to drag us into the war. Like, which of those is more sophisticated of an operation? To make it, to drag the U.S. into the war in Syria by making something look like it wasn't. And by the way, I think the truth is now, you know, truth is first casualty of war. The truth is unobtainable now in that area. I don't know how, I mean, I'm sure we are in overdrive creating our own evidence, and the Russians are in overdrive creating their own evidence, and the rebels are creating their evidence. Who knows what the facts will be. So anyways, those are just a few things that I wanted to talk about that are behind the scenes in Congress, some things that you may not hear about in the news. And I wanted to leave you with this. As I said, I walked in the day that the month that Ron Paul walked out, and I knew, I studied that some members of Congress, they go to the drain the swamp and the swamp drains them. And what I realized is it's really important how you pick your staff, because each congressman has 16 staffers, roughly, and they really are your policy. You have very little time. It's like standing in front of a tennis ball machine trying to keep up with all the issues that are coming across your plate. So your staff is really the one that's going to field these. So I decided it was very important to pick the right staff. And I wanted a diverse staff. If you don't have any arguments in your office, Daniel can tell you this, and if you don't have any arguments in your office, then you may just lock in on the wrong answer too soon. So I decided to get a diverse staff. Half of my staff are Ron Paul people, and the other half are Rand Paul people. So we have great arguments every day. Thank you very much.
Well, thanks, Congressman Massey. Appreciate that very much. Ladies and gentlemen, if anybody in the room is not currently reading David Stockman, you should be. Of course, some of you probably remember he was director of OMB under Reagan. He was a congressman prior to that. But far more importantly, from my perspective anyway, is that he wrote what I think is one of the most important financial books ever written, and certainly the most important financial book of the 21st century, called The Great Deformation, which not only explains the crash of 2008, but also explains so much about central banking and how it finances all kinds of evil in the decades prior. He has a new book out called Trumped, which somebody needs to get to Trump and have him read it ASAP, because I'm afraid without that, we are going to be lost in some kind of a cataclysm of spending. But David Stockman runs a website called Contra Corner. He is an absolute tireless writer against crony capitalism, and I think he's one of the leading lights in our movement today. Thanks so much, David Stockman.
Well, thank you very much for that warm welcome. It's the first time anybody's applauded since way back in 1985 when they ran me out of Washington on a rail in the Reagan administration. But I really want to give my sincere appreciation to Jeff for saying a good thing about my book, The Great Deformation. Because when it came out in 2013, it was denounced by every point on the political compass, the Republicans and the Democrats and the liberals and the conservatives. And Wall Street hated it, and the military-industrial complex found it offensive. And it got denounced wildly, loudly by the neocons in the Congress and the social cons and the tax cons and the just cons, which is about everybody else left there. But I expected it to some degree, because I said, you know, the book is saying we're heading to a terrible dystopia where the Fed is destroying capitalism, where Imperial Washington is wrecking the world with all its interventions, where we're going bankrupt because of this government that can't stop spending and borrowing. So I expected some blowback, let's call it. But, you know, I thought at one point one of the critics went way over the top, and that was your friend Professor Paul Krugman, who the day the book came out wrote a blog called The Rantings of a Cranky Old Man. And that was what he had to say about my book. But, you know, that was going so far that it even aroused my 88-year-old mother, who, upon reading his blog, shot me an email saying, "Doesn't he know? You were a cranky young man, too." And the point is that I think there are a lot of cranky people in America who responded to what I had to say, because within one day after that cranky old man blog, my book, and I'm not bragging here, went to number 4 on the Amazon bestseller list. And the only thing ahead of it was 2 diet books and something novel, a horror novel called The Walking Dead. So I thought, well, maybe there is an audience out there. But the true point of the matter is that it did end up number 3 on the New York Times bestseller list. And again, I'm not bragging, because after 3 years, they're still debating at the New York Times whether that was number 3 on the fiction or the nonfiction category. But in any event, I'm very happy to be here, to be part of this conference on war and peace. I think we're on the war part today, at least as a result of the events of the last couple of days. But I do want to give just a quick update, Jeff, on your point about the general getting all hot and bothered about the Tomahawks. Here's the news flash on the Tomahawks. They fired 59. 36 of them were duds that landed in the desert somewhere. 23 hit the airfields. None of them hit the runway. They're launching sorties today from the runway that we didn't hit. Not a single operable plane was taken out. What they did hit was 3 Butler buildings, otherwise known as hangars, and a graveyard for inoperable planes that have been sitting there for the last who knows how long. So the point is, this was kind of a random, crazy thing. Where did it come from? 2 days, no investigation possible, plenty of circumstantial reasons to think that this was a false flag, very much like what happened back in August 2013. Everybody's forgot about that, the Gota event, so-called. But when you go back and look at what some of the objective evidence is, investigations today, it's pretty clear that it wasn't launched by the regime. It was launched by local jihadist radicals who are trying to bait Obama into doing exactly what Trump did 2 days ago when he had foolishly put out that red line. I also want to, before we get into the main topic, want to welcome everyone. I was delighted to hear that there are people here from Mexico and Canada. And hopefully you'll come back next year, even if you have to leap the wall when the thing actually gets built. Jeff had a very good observation about the think tanks, which just have proliferated everywhere in Washington, and I'm going to talk about that. They all say the same thing. I turned on cable news Thursday night, and you couldn't find anything from MSNBC to CNN to Fox that said anything different. There are all these generals, all these consultants, all these think tank experts, all these National Security Council types, all saying the same thing. They were in war heat. And so it reminds me today, Jeff, that really you don't have a whole bunch of think tanks around Washington. You have a whole bunch of groupthink tanks. They all think the same thing because they're all paid by the same paymaster, which I call the warfare state. In a moment, we'll get into some of the detail, but it's a trillion-dollar monster that basically feeds the prosperity of the Beltway. That's why I call it the Imperial City. And everything in the Imperial City today is compromised, but most especially the news media. I was just struck, to tell you the truth. I was appalled when I heard the great guru. You know, in the pecking order of things, there are some people that are felt to be the real thoughtful leaders of the media today. One of them is Fareed Zakaria. And when I heard him say on CNN Thursday night, as they were showing in the background all the flashing from the bombs hitting and so forth, that tonight Donald Trump became president because he was foolish and rash enough to launch an unconstitutional, illegal, unnecessary, pointless attack on an airfield in Syria, it sort of brought it all together and told me really what we're up against and why things like what Ron Paul is doing and what Mises is doing is so critically important, because there is a totally different view on what's going on in the world if you get your lens right and if you're not part of this overwhelming groupthink consensus that is literally suffocating the machinery of government, the machinery of the mainstream media in Washington today. And that's why we're at this point, I think, that we're at. I also wanted, before I get into a little more substance, I want to acknowledge how much I admire and how grateful I am for all the work in behalf of the cause of peace, and that's really what it is, that Ron Paul has done over so many decades. I consider him really a national treasure, a person that I've admired for the last 40 years since we both sat together in the Congress in 1978. And the interesting thing about that is that we were both kind of free market, rabid free market types, and we sat way in the back benches and we were being totally ignored by everyone, because they thought that what we were focused on entirely was the free market. But actually, we were working on an issue that is the issue of the day. Ron was really, at that point, a closet peacenik. And little did they understand that I was a 30-year-old congressman at the time, and 10 years earlier, I'd been out on the barricades as a member of SDS protesting the war in Vietnam and really trying to disrupt the machine, and we've been going in the wrong direction ever since. And here we are today, and I'm more convinced than ever that what we were saying about the aggressive, expansionist, interventionist foreign policy then in 1968 that led to the folly of Vietnam is even more true today. And that's why history, I think, is so important, perspective. A lot of you probably travel. If you've ever been to Vietnam, you have to go to Hanoi if you're traveling to Southeast Asia, or go to Saigon. And ask yourself, what in the hell were we doing putting 500,000 young Americans, billions of dollars, dropping on the country from one end to the other, napalm and every other kind of horrible thing out of the sky. Why were we doing that back in 1960s? What was the point? There is no trace of anything accomplished, any purpose, any valid objective for 50 years later. In fact, Vietnam is now becoming a major supplier of goods and services to the United States. So I just think that maybe we need to have a little perspective, historical perspective. And I have to say that in light of the event 2 days ago, I had to change the title of my speech. It originally was The Deep State and the Donald. And the whole idea was that in some ways he was a victim already of the deep state. They were trying to relitigate the election. That's what all of this Russiagate hysteria is about. And I thought they're not going to win even if they wound and undermine him badly and even destroy his presidency, because at least he's an impetuous bomb thrower that would help to begin to, discredit and unmask this huge surveillance state that has grown up in the hysteria after 9/11. Well, little did I know that suddenly Donald Trump has been taken hostage by the deep state. And before we knew it, he's ending up being the tool of the deep state. And that's really the topic that I want to address today. How did this happen? How did it happen so fast in a few days that a president that they were literally after attempting to drive from the very Oval Office, how did it end up that he did undertook the act that was so rash, so uncalled for? Even after, by the way, everybody's familiar with all the tweets that he put out in 2013 when Obama was on the brink after the false flag attack in August. You read all of them. Don't do it. How can you get involved in a civil war when there are two sides and you want to fight both of them? It's none of our business. They haven't attacked us. There is no possible danger. The only thing you could do is compound and exacerbate the most complex sectarian battle, conflict, civil war that we've ever seen. So he was right then. He was right last week when he sent his Secretary of State out to say, you know, regime change is done. That was one of the fundamental propositions of his campaign. Regime change doesn't work. That's not our role, obviously. And so what? Here we are. In 3 days, the regime change is behind, thrown overboard. He had his neocon, ambassador to the UN saying the same thing. And since Nikki Haley basically reads out of the playbook that Samantha Powers left behind from the Obama administration, I'm sure it was tough for her to get out the words that we've decided not to take Assad out. But now here we are, and everything has changed, and he's back in the groove. So the question that I asked to myself was, well, what is the purpose of this attack after 2 days, no investigation of what really happened in Idlib province in that little town where obviously it looks like they hit an ammo dump, and there could have well been, and there's plenty of suggestions that there were both regular ammunition and chemical weapons being stored there. But what was he possibly trying to accomplish if it's not regime change, if it's not taking out the entire Air Force and Army of the Syrians? What is he trying to accomplish? And the only thing that I can think of is that, and they've said it, Assad had to be punished. And so, the question comes to your mind, who appointed Donald Trump to be the global spanker-in-chief for any dictator or leader of a country that misbehaves? And that is not a basis for a foreign policy. That's not a valid basis for attacking any country. And if you want to be spanker-in-chief, why don't you take a look at the leader of Egypt who was in the Oval Office a week or two ago? He's murdered thousands of his political opponents since he illegally took power in a coup several years ago. If you want to be spanker-in-chief and compel behavior, and this is the thing that Fareed Zakaria was saying, finally, the president has realized that there are standards in the world and it's the job of the United States to enforce those standards, and if occasionally we have to use military power, let's do it. He was applauding that. Well, then where are the standards in this horrendous civil war that's going on in Yemen? We are arming the Saudis with every kind of destructive device, bomb, missile, drone, that there is. They wouldn't have the firepower that they do without all this U.S.-supplied munitions. So far, 10,000 civilians have been casualties, 4,000 killed, men, women, and children, weddings, and all the rest of it, 6,000 injured. Many of them from cluster bombs, which are supplied by Textron to the Saudi government that is using it on the civilian population of Yemen. So if you want to be the spanker-in-chief, bring in the king of Saudi Arabia and, give him a whack or two. The point is, it makes no sense. There's no justification for it, and yet that's about the only thing that I can think of that Donald Trump may be up to. So the question that I want to kind of try to answer a little bit is, how in 77 days did this outlaw, renegade, guy who said a few things in the campaign that made sense, like let's make a deal with Putin, we don't have to have a war with Putin, let's get out of the Middle East, regime change has been a disaster, we've got rubble and destroyed states and millions of refugees and blowback of every time everywhere. He said all this. How in 77 days is he doing something as stupid, as immoral, as short-sighted, as impulsive, as starting a major conflict with the Assad government and getting exactly into harm's way with Russia and all of its allies that are on the ground there, the Iranians, Hezbollah, and all the rest of them. How did this happen in 77 days? And I think what I would like to do is suggest that the deep state, or the warfare state, or whatever you want to call it, has gotten so massive, the military-industrial, congressional surveillance complex, and so forth, that it envelops everything that enters the imperial city, that enters the White House, the Oval Office, and therefore the kind of challenge and problem and threat, really, that we face from this thing is far greater than almost anybody could imagine if they could even take down Donald Trump within such a short period of time. Now, let's just say how big it is. I call it the trillion-dollar monster. And that's because if you take the $600 billion that's admitted to in the defense budget, you add about $50 billion for security assistance and foreign aid and all the rest of it. You add another $70 billion that goes into homeland security and an extension of the warfare state at home. $180 billion for veterans, and after all, we're spending $180 billion on veterans because we've had all these wars since Vietnam, since the last 50 years that have been pointless, and we've ended up with all of these young men and women who need medical care or compensation or pensions and so forth. None of that ever should have happened, so charge it to the warfare state. Add a little bit of carry cost for the debt, which is now $20 billion, and you got a trillion-dollar monster with funds flowing in every direction. And especially in the imperial city, you have a $75 billion complex for the 17 agencies of the intelligence community. Now, the difference between what I call the intelligence complex and the old-fashioned notion of the military-industrial is that at least the military-industrial complex was spread all over the world and spread all over the country. We had bases all over the country, defense contractors all over, 200,000 forces abroad that shouldn't be there, and so forth. But when you get to the intelligence community, it is concentrated, massed in the greater metropolitan area of D.C. I think there's 200,000 or 300,000 or 400,000 contractors or direct employees. If you take the $75 billion budget of the CIA, NASA, and all the rest of them, $50 billion of it goes to contracts. And so you have all these huge contracting companies that are paying people big, big salaries, not GS 16 or 18 salaries, but huge salaries. You create that entire mass concentration of people all needing a justification for a continuation of the flow of all this money. That's why when you go into Washington, I don't go to Washington that much anymore, Congressman, but when I do, compared to what I saw when I started there in 1970 or even when I left in 1985, the prosperity is amazing. And you say to yourself, where is all this prosperity, this glass and steel and all these new hotels and restaurants and all of this fancy stuff coming from in a city that has no manufacturing, has no industry? Where does it come from? It's coming from the $75 billion intelligence complex that's sprawled all over the entire metro area. So part of that, obviously, is the group think tanks. Part of that is the media that's housed there. I mean, Wolf Blitzer, can you stand to listen to another night of Wolf Blitzer drooling over, the next occupation or intervention or stage of the war? They're all down there embedded in that horrible environment that's been created. Now, my point is that if there were some kind of existential threat to the very future of our society, of our democracy, of our system, some horrible, immense, powerful, terminal threat to our existence, maybe that would be a justification for what we have. But I want to spend a couple minutes telling you that the real secret, and we need to get it out and sort of preach the gospel, is we have no serious industrial, technological, military threat anywhere on the planet. Instead of an existential threat, we have less of a threat than we've had since 1917 when Wilson foolishly put us into the First World War. And let's just tick off what is out there. The first one, obviously, is Russia. And you know, that's a joke. If they're going to land on the shores of New Jersey, they would need vast power projection capability, aircraft carriers and suites of capacity to land. I know I'm being facetious, but the point is none of that is remotely possible because they've got one 50-year-old, aging, smoke-belching aircraft carrier that's on duty in the Eastern Mediterranean and probably couldn't get out of the Straits of Gibraltar if it had to. That's it. So how do they threaten the security or the safety of anybody in America unless you think Putin, who is the ultimate chess player, the cool hand Luke of the global scene today, is foolish enough to risk nuclear retaliation by attacking us first and have all of Russia turned into a parking lot. The point is, we have had the nuclear deterrent on our Trident submarines more than enough ever since I was there fighting the defense buildup in 1980. We don't need any more money. There's nothing that the Russians are going to do that remotely threatens us. And as a matter of fact, just to give you some feel for how silly this whole damn thing is, I actually am fortunate enough to live in New York City and on the 19th floor of a very nice apartment building on the East River. And when I look out from my balcony, I can see the Queens on the other side, and I look south and I can see Brooklyn. I look north on one side, there's Harlem, and on another side, there's the Bronx. And also, I can see the entirety of Russia from the balcony of my apartment in New York City. Now, I'm not doing a Sarah Palin on you, okay? I'm not talking about the Siberian landmass. I'm talking about the fact that the GDP that I can see from my balcony of New York metro area is $1.6 trillion, and the GDP of Russia is $1.3 trillion. In other words, entire economy of Russia is not even as big as New York City. It's 1/7 of the GDP of the United States. Russia is mainly a huge hydrocarbon field with a few nickel mines, 100 million acres of wheat, and an aging workforce that has a great fondness for vodka and other distractions. So the point is, there is nothing there that could ever generate a threat or the military capability to harm us. Now, China is the same thing. You know, if you think about it, do you really worry at night that China is going to send some missiles or a fleet of aircraft over the Pacific in order to bomb 4,000 Walmarts in America? I mean, the point is, their economy would collapse within 6 months if they didn't have this global, bloated global system of exports and trade. That's what the whole Red Ponzi is predicated upon. And if they want to build sandcastles in the South China Sea, more power to them. But they aren't a threat to us, and frankly, they're not a threat to any of their neighbors either, because they depend on a huge supply of raw materials coming up through the South China Sea into their ports, and all the intermediate products that come from all the nearby countries like South Korea, Taiwan, Malaysia, and so forth. Now, my point today is, can't we learn a lesson from the demise of the Soviet Union in the 80s? You know, one of the things I had to do over and over when I was in the budget office was fight this massive buildup of defense spending that Reagan got convinced to do. When the Soviet Union was dying on its own accord, because it was predicated on a centralized, socialist-controlled economy that was falling apart. And the only thing we really needed to do was just wait it out, and sure enough, it did. It wasn't the Reagan buildup. It wasn't Star Wars. All the money that went into that Reagan buildup ended up, ironically, going into conventional weapons. It didn't go into strategic defense. It didn't go into strategic offense. It went into tanks, and it went into a 600-ship Navy and more aircraft carriers and more cruise missiles and Tomahawks and so forth, all the things that subsequently got used for the wars of invasion and occupation that we never should have undertaken. But my point is, let's learn from that mistake and realize that China is a red Ponzi of historic proportion, that 20 years ago, the debt of all of China was $500 billion. Today, it's $30 trillion. That you don't blow up the debt of a system by 60-fold, 60x, in two decades and create a frenzy of building and speculating and borrowing and gambling, really, and expect the system to be stable, sustainable, when there are no market mechanisms to discipline it, or there's no honesty in the system, since they all lie up and down the channel. So my point is, we only need to wait it out. We don't have to get excited about the China threat either. And frankly, we don't have to get that excited about the terrorism threat either. And if we wanted to do something about it, that's the third item, we ought to stop bombing and droning and occupying, because it's the blowback from that that's created what does exist today as a terrorist threat. And I think all of you know that, because all you have to do is ask yourself, before 1990, how many terrorist incidents do you remember? Not many, and most of them had to do with intramurals between the Palestinians and the Israelis. It had nothing to do with us. It had nothing to do with Europe. And all of a sudden, allegedly, we're more in peril than ever before in history. Well, where did all this come from? It started with Gulf War I. What in the world were we doing trying to argue, resolve, or intervene in a fight between the emir of Kuwait, who was directionally drilling into Saddam's oil field, and Saddam was pissed off, and pretty soon he decided to take over the oil field. And the next thing we knew, George Bush said, this will not stand. We had 500,000 troops on the sands of Saudi Arabia. The Mujahideen that we had armed and trained to fight the Soviets became offended because we were defacing the Holy Lands, and the next thing we knew, we ended up where we are today. But the point is, stop the intervention. The blowback will die out. The threat will eventually disappear. But beyond that, they're not coming over here anyway. And I just have to get this point across. I had it in my book that I wrote on Trump. And that is, I got very upset during the campaign when he was talking about terrorists everywhere, lurking behind every bush. So I went and checked it out. And it turns out, if you take this time frame, which is 15 years, between 9/11 and that last unfortunate incident done by the lone wolves in San Bernardino, which I think was December 2014, in that period, 420 Americans were killed by lightning, okay? And six Americans, civilians, were killed by terrorist acts outside of military bases. So that gives you a little bit of perspective about the fact that 99.9% of the American people in the towns and cities and villages and farms of America are not imperiled by terrorists. And this huge, massive system that we've created to combat them is part of the problem, not part of the solution. And, so it leads to the system to keep itself alive leads to what I call endless false narratives. Because if there isn't an enemy, if there isn't an imminent threat, if there isn't danger lurking everywhere, even if it's more from lightning than it is from terrorists, then over time it becomes hard to justify all of this money that is being wasted in this massive system. So I want to mention, how much time do we have left, Jeff? I want to mention just one or two, and then we'll take... Okay, I want to mention one or two, because this is one of the things I do in my blog, and I think it's important that we educate people about what is taken for granted as truths in the day-to-day mainstream media, which is totally distorting of the facts and is creating a false case for this massive system that led Donald Trump to try to bomb an airfield, which even that didn't happen. You know, one of them is Russia is an expansionist power, and if they can't get to the New Jersey shores, they're going to take over all of Europe. And how do we know that? Well, because allegedly they occupied Crimea. All right, now here are the facts on Crimea. Catherine the Great bought Crimea for hard gold money in 1783 from the Turks, who were desperate for cash. It was a stalwart part of Russia for 200 years. Sevastopol, the main port, became the home port for the Black Sea Fleet, the heart of the Russian Navy under czars and commissars alike. And it was not until 1956, after being in the heart of the Russian Empire. In fact, the charge of the Light Brigade occurred in Crimea, and it was the occupying invaders who were charging the English, and it was the Russian patriots who were defending the homeland. That's the point. But it wasn't until 1956, after the succession of Stalin was resolved and Khrushchev had killed off his two rivals. And Khrushchev, as you remember, was a Ukrainian, so in a night of drunken celebration with his comrades from Kiev and the Ukraine, they decided they would transfer in the Soviet Empire Crimea from Russia to the Ukraine. That's how it happens. So we're supposed to start a war today in order to compel Russia to return Crimea because invasion that we helped, or a coup that we helped start in 2014. My point is, Crimea has been part of Russia and provided them with a warm water port for 173 years, which is longer than California has been part of the United States when we got our warm water port in California. The point is, there are a lot of these that we could talk about. One other that I just want to mention, and then I'll take some questions, is we're constantly being told that they need these billions of dollars to do the policing on the homeland, all this homeland security stuff, because there are terror cells everywhere. But I think, Congressman, you've probably looked at this, but the fact is that about 90% of these so-called busts of terror cells are FBI stings. And one of my great, anyone who wants to get educated on the terrorist threat needs to only go back and watch Paul Newman and Robert Redford's movie of 40 years ago called The Sting, and you will see exactly what's going on today. But most of them are sting operations, and the latest one was, and I just mentioned this in closing, the latest one was in Kansas City, where the FBI agents cultivated for several weeks a young man who was so destitute, so out of it, such a loser, who his wife had left him and had a young son, that the FBI had to give him $30 and babysit his son while he went to Walmart to buy a list of stuff that they had given him, like copper wires and batteries and fertilizer and a few other incriminating things. Now, this may be an extreme case, but the point is, this is part of what I call this false narrative that's constantly going on. So the bottom line, I guess, of my point today is that maybe there's a silver lining in this latest capture of Trump by the deep state, this utterly stupid attack on Syria. And that is, maybe it will help revive a coalition, an anti-war coalition in the Congress, like the one that I started with way back in 1968, when both non-interventionists like Senator Aiken from Vermont and doves from the Democrat side came together and basically put Johnson out of business, stopped the war, and ended the madness. Maybe now the liberals and the so-called progressives will come back to life. I mean, they've been essentially sidelined during the whole Obama era because anything he did, they had to justify. But if we have an opportunity now to tell Trump that you can't do this without congressional authorization, and a real debate begins in Congress, which I think is beginning to happen, maybe we can revive some kind of resistance, some kind of opposition to the madness that's been going on. And I, in this setting, I want to particularly commend Rand Paul for the tremendous leadership, the astute and brilliant representation of this position that he's doing day after day in the Senate, and he goes on the media and he just leaves them totally flummoxed because he, in a calm way, is laying out the facts of the case. And so I consider Rand, just like his father, to be one of the great patriots of America. In fact, to sum it up, when you think of what Rand is willing to do to defend the Constitution and the right way for the foreign policy to be conducted, to defend the position of non-intervention and a more peaceful foreign policy. He is willing to go so far as that I read this morning that he's trying to form a coalition for bringing this to the Senate floor with Senator Pocahontas from Massachusetts. And that I would say that's going a mile and beyond. So at least there's some glimmerings of hope, but frankly, the groupthink is killing us. The warfare state is suffocating Washington. The war machine is bankrupting and draining the fiscal and economic resources of America, and the hour is getting late. So maybe there's a chance to turn it around, and maybe inadvertently Donald Trump gave us that opportunity 2 days ago. Thank you very much.
I think we're up against a break. We'll take a break until 11, then we'll come back with our panels. Thanks very much to David Stockman and Thomas Massey for joining us this morning.
Ladies and gentlemen, if you'd please take your seats, we'll begin shortly.
Ladies and gentlemen, please take your seats. Good morning. My name is Nicole Papakostas. I'm an alumna of Mises Institute. I attended Mises Institute for the first time last year, and it was such a great experience meeting so many wonderful people that has helped me to see economics and the world with different eyes. Mises definitely changed my life in a good way, and that's why I'm here today to say thank you to all our donors that make possible, not only to me, but to a lot of students from around the world to have this experience at Mises Institute. Please help me to give a hand to all our donors. Now please join me in welcoming Mr. Daniel McAdams from Ron Paul Institute for Peace and Prosperity. Thank you.
Good morning, everyone, and welcome to Lake Jackson. It's my home and Dr. Paul's home, and we're happy to have you here. Special thanks to all of our supporters for the Ron Paul Institute. We really appreciate all of you, and we had a nice time last night with you. I also want to say welcome to the over 1,000 people that are watching us online right now. That's tremendous. Talk about technology helping us spread the message. It's just amazing. So that's wonderful. I want to thank The Mises Institute especially, this was Jeff and Lou's idea to do something down here. Dr. Paul and I wondered if anyone would come out to our little hamlet down in Lake Jackson, but you all did, and we're happy. And it was such a delight and such a pleasure to work with Jeff and the Mises Institute, and they have a wonderful staff. It runs like clockwork, so it's a joy. And you know, it's great to work with the Mises Institute because we have so much overlap in a way. People say Mises does economics, we do foreign policy. A lot of people say, oh, Ron, I love your economics, but I hate your foreign policy. Those on the progressive left might say, I love your foreign policy, can't stand your economics. But Jeff said it much better than I could. They are intertwined. The Fed enables the wars that we fight, and the wars that we fight enable the Fed. So it's very important, I think, that people understand the package that we have. The Ron Paul Institute is in its fourth year. I'll be very brief about it. People turn to us in times of crisis in very large numbers, which is what we wanted to do when we started it. Dr. Paul and I did a show on Wednesday on the Ron Paul Liberty Report, right after the news hit about the Syrian so-called chemical attack. That show that we did immediately went viral, with now well over 200,000 views of the show. We put the show up on our Facebook page, and 1 million people looked at it immediately. So it's really incredible what you can do. And we work hard in both the print media, and we have a little studio down here in Lake Jackson where we can do our daily show, and we can also do our media hits. So it's times of crisis like this that we're happy that people will turn to us for an alternative from what you've heard the mainstream media's chorus. I'm going to do something a little different just for a minute, and I think it's almost a sort of a poetry. I'm going to just simply read the headlines from today's antiwar.com and just ponder and think of every one of them for a second as I read them. Hawkish Dems cheer Trump attack on Syria. Tomahawk maker Raytheon fuels defense sector rally. 45 times Trump said attacking Syria was a bad idea. Lawmakers say proof lacking before Trump bombed Syria. Lacking Syria plan, U.S. threatens more strikes. Syria, U.S. missile attack killed 9 civilians. Huh. Is Assad to blame for the chemical weapons attack in Syria? Syrian rebels call for more U.S. attacks. U.S. says Russia responsible for Syria gas attack. Russia cuts military communications with U.S. over Syria attack. Russian Prime Minister, U.S. attacks in Syria, one step away from Russia clashes. ISIS kills dozens of civilians fleeing Mosul. And finally, U.S. considers putting nukes in South Korea. So that's just a random, and it tells you where we are. It tells you the mess we're in. We've talked about the strikes, the 59 Tomahawk strikes at a cost of $1.5 million each, fueling the defense sector rally in the markets. But this was not the first U.S. strike on Syria. As a matter of fact, it was the 7,899th airstrike on Syria from when President Obama started in late 2014. So this didn't begin yesterday. Circumstances around it made it more dramatic. Did Assad gas the people in this village in the Homs area the other day? Well, we don't know that he did. We don't know that he didn't. If he did, it would have to be one of the most reckless acts or an act of insanity probably from any leader in history. Judging on past behavior, and this is certainly no praise for him, does he act like a madman? He's been able to helm his country in a war against almost impossible odds, where jihadist rebels that were backed by Saudi Arabia and Turkey and other countries, the U.S., were determined to overthrow him. Yet, in a very cool and calculated way, he developed alliances with Iran and with Russia and was able to beat them back. Hardly seems the motion of a madman or someone very reckless. He was on the verge of winning the war. It was literally days before peace talks were supposed to begin for a political solution, and less than a week after, the White House said, Assad can stay, it's up to the Syrian people to choose their own president. So in these circumstances, he was fighting Al-Qaeda in the area in Idlib. Would he launch a chemical attack and kill a few groups of civilians? It doesn't make sense. Maybe he did. We won't know, probably. But you have to ask yourself, as in any crime, who benefits? Is there any way conceivable that Assad benefits from doing this. He risks alienating his two allies that have literally saved his bacon in Syria. He risks being Gaddafi'd in the end. Is it good for him? I don't see how it is. ISIS and Al-Qaeda, on the other hand, were on the ropes, ready for defeat. Did they benefit from this? Well, they certainly cheered it, and immediately after the missiles hit, they started moving on some villages in the area where the strikes were and took advantage of it. A couple of other points I want to make before we get to our panel discussion. I think the China factor is important, and I think it was David, or perhaps it was Representative Massey who mentioned, the missile strikes were launched as President Trump was having dinner with Chinese Premier Xi. They were sitting down to dinner as the missiles flew. If that wasn't intended to send a message to both China and particularly North Korea, I don't know what was. I think that may have been the real target, and I think that might have been why we didn't see a lot of damage. The Russian reaction. This is probably what I worry about most today. The Russians have not backed down. They've stood by Assad. They've said there's no evidence. We know the last time we thought it was Assad, it turns out, at least according to Carla Del Ponte, the UN inspector, she concluded it was probably the rebels. We almost went to war then. Believe it or not, Obama was sane enough not to do it. But I want to talk a little bit about the Russians, and I'm just going to quote very, very briefly, because Prime Minister Medvedev is not known as a fire breather. He is almost considered to be too liberal. He's no Putin, let's put it that way. This is what Medvedev, a very quiet man, said yesterday. That's it. The last remaining election fog is lifted. Instead of an overworked statement about a joint fight against the biggest enemy, ISIS, the Trump administration proved they will fiercely fight the legitimate Syrian government in a tough contradiction with international law, without UN approval, in violation of its own procedures, stipulating that Congress must first be notified of any military operation unrelated to aggression against the U.S., on the verge of a military clash with Russia. Nobody is overestimating the value of pre-election promises, but there must be limits of decency. He seems to know our Constitution better than Trump does. So what's next? We're back to the beginning. I think we are in big trouble right now. I think maybe we all feel the tension in the room. I think we're potentially on the verge of something cataclysmic. As I said, Moscow said we are one step from war with the U.S. And what did Trump say today? Quote, this is on Drudge, I'd hit Assad again, is what he said. So the idea that Assad did this because he's simply crazy, I'm starting to wonder if Trump did what he did because he's simply crazy. So maybe the shoe's on the other foot. But I want to announce our panel to take a little bit more of a look at this. And first, I have someone I know very well, and I have someone that I know his work, but we have not met in person yet. And Phil Giraldi, I've known for quite some time. Phil is a regular contributor to our institute's website. He's one of my favorite writers. He writes from experience. He spent a couple of decades in the CIA in operations. He knows the Middle East like the back of his hand. And he's a terrific writer. He's always uncovering something. And Phil, I think, is just such an asset to our movement, what we're trying to do, someone who's been there and knows it. Professor T. Hunt Tooley is the chairman of the History Department at Austin College. And his expertise really is the Great War, which is so appropriate today. He's the author of The Great War, Western Front and Home Front. And I think it's excellent that the Mises Institute invited him because this sort of pulls the strings together. So welcome, panelists. Let's sit down and have a conversation. What we're going to do is each panelist will present, 5 to 7 minute synopsis of what they are thinking about. And then we will open it up to a discussion, and we would like to involve all of you in the discussion. There are little microphones, I'm told, that you can throw at each other and ask questions. When the questions do come, please make sure they are phrased in the form of a succinct question so we can get as many people in and so we can answer specific questions. So let's get started. Phil?
Can you hear me? Okay. Dan and David Stockman between them stole virtually everything I was going to say. So what I'll try to do is throw out a few comments, which I hope will be supplementary to what they've suggested. And these won't be in any specific order or not necessarily connected. but hopefully they'll be useful. The first thing I would ask people to consider is that the premise for this conference is actually incorrect. I would suggest that the United States actually doesn't have a foreign policy. A foreign policy, virtually by definition, is a coherent plan that essentially pulls together different elements in terms of how the United States interacts with the rest of the world. What we've been seeing ever since 9/11 is essentially something quite different. We've been seeing a reaction to what is going on in the rest of the world, and the original intention of a foreign policy to protect American interests and to protect Americans traveling or in business has basically been abandoned. So I think that's something that people should consider. We have really walked away from what the principle was for having a foreign policy as seen by Jefferson and others. Another thing that occurred to me when I was listening to the previous speeches was that in my own history, I voted for George W. Bush in 2000, I voted for Obama twice, and I voted for Trump. In every case, the reasoning was exactly the same. These people represented to me the peace candidates, in some cases only by virtue of who they were running against, but the fact was they were people that were promising a change of direction in terms of the United States and how we conduct our policies. In terms of what I did and what they have done, I would deduce that we've been betrayed, that basically the people in this country, which I think both from the right and left constitute a considerable part of the electorate that really do want peace, have been betrayed by both parties. And I think this is something to consider, that the peace movement that David Stockman was talking about, I think is actually much bigger than we see it, because we generally come out of our own bubbles, politically speaking, and from our own bubble, we may not see that there are people that are politically on the other side that share a lot of our concerns. The trick will be to bring all of this together. Another thing that David brought up was essentially that the investigations of what happened in Syria, just like Russiagate, will probably produce no result. And I think that's an accurate assumption on his part. But coming out of the intelligence community, I would say the sad thing about this is that the intelligence community and the U.S. government know exactly what happened in both cases. But whether this will ever come out or not is doubtful. I think what we really need is a whistleblower, and I think in people in their conversations with people who work for the government in national security should subtly hint to people that this might be a good idea. Finally, I think it's important to assess just how serious what is going on today in Syria really is. I consider this just as bad as the invasion of Iraq, and there are two reasons for that. For one thing, ISIS was on the verge of destruction. It's gone the other way. The other thing was the Russian relationship was improving. That's gone the other way. These are extremely serious issues, and I think that they're going to be very destructive for the United States if Trump is not reined in. Thank you.
Am I on? Is that on? Okay. I think this is a very good time to talk about peace and war from a historical perspective. It's a good idea, since 100 years ago this week, we began the week at peace and we ended the week at war. So we're talking today in part about prospects for peace today. Are there prospects? And as a historian, I'm a little bit conflicted there, because historians are pretty good with the past and we're pretty bad with the future. So I remember the day I told my, or the 2 weeks I told my students that the Berlin Wall, which I'd just been seeing after a research trip to East Germany, would not fall in my lifetime or theirs, and 2 weeks later it fell. So they were pretty pleased, you can imagine. So I have three short points, and two are kind of historical, and one is not quite as historical. First of all, this vilification of Russia that we see in the press, this systematic cranking up of the steam, and above all of Putin as yet one more face of evil. I've been working a lot lately, thinking about American intervention into the war in a course of a series of essays, and I'm just put in mind of the whole run up to World War One and American intervention in particular. The press was pretty much British subventioned, but there were many, many forces of the government that really made it appear that the Kaiser was the face of evil and that the Germans were the root of all evil. This was a technique that had been invented a while before by the British, but it was used in this big way to say, okay, focus people's ideas on this one face of evil. A phrase, by the way, which Time magazine adopted, beginning with many tyrants in our times, Gaddafi and many others. But since then, it has become much more sophisticated, and we've got a virtual machinery of creating faces of evil in that same imperial city that David Stockman mentioned. And they can really crank them out on demand and make everybody that same sort of Time magazine face of evil. So this has become the indispensable part of the sort of propaganda for war, I think. And that's where we find ourselves today, looking at Assad. And we had to have at this point some kind of terrible event with children involved. The second point is that there were in the period of World War One. As I say, I've been working on American intervention, and it's tragic but exciting material to study. One aspect, the heroic rearguard action by about 50 members of the House and six or eight senators who just fought like mad to keep that war from happening, in spite of having the deck stacked against them and so forth. They filibustered an armed ships bill, which Fighting Bob La Follette said would mean war if it passed, and they filibustered that out of existence. But a few days later, the administration was able to conquer anyway and just persuade everybody. The vote was 50 congressmen opposed and six senators, La Follette and Norris and others opposed. But I want to point out this, and thinking about this, they did all this without a coherent anti-war, anti-interventionist movement with a deep background of economic and political philosophy behind it. They did it without Ron Paul. They did it without the Ron Paul Institute. They did it without the Mises Institute. So I say all honor to their names, but I do believe that puts us in a better situation today. Finally, just a very short point. If peace is to have a chance, let me give my opinion. It won't come because of some individual politician who comes to power and makes peace. It has to come from changing minds and perceptions, something that I suppose all of us in this room are engaged in and a part of. Education at all levels is certainly the key, and in this regard, there is, I think, since 2003, and above all since 2008 and the election, there is a huge growth in the understanding of the deep state, and therefore I'm optimistic about the prospects for peace.
Thank you very much, Professor. Thank you, Phil, for your comments. I'm going to take the right of the chair, I guess, and ask a couple of questions, one each of you. Professor Julia, I'm fascinated by the media. I always have been. I think it's such an important part of how it shapes our opinions and our views of the world. And I think you made a very interesting comment at the time of World War One, what a strong role the media played in the indecision. One thing I noticed when the Syrian missiles flew and the stories came out of why, it seemed like the media, in the large sense, was completely bifurcated. And I mean, on the one hand, the mainstream media was lockstep, as David Stockman mentioned, lockstep behind. But, and Jeff Deist has mentioned this, we now can create our own media, for better or for worse,
through social media. And I went on to my Twitter and my Facebook, and I looked at the people and the institutions that I follow, and it was night and day. They were questioning. They were speculating. In some cases, they were conspiracizing, if that's a word. So what do you make of this idea that the media monopoly has been broken?
Oh, I think that's really important. I think it's vital to everything we're doing. I mean, think of the multitude of sort of network connections that end up with all of us being here together in this room. At this point, those of us who sort of appeared, you know, at the Mises Institute, walked up to the Mises Institute door and walked in one day, that we're getting to be pretty few and far between. So that's been an amazing kind of phenomenon. And you're right, I did exactly the same thing, and I thought, well, I'll go find some, it depends on when I think facetiously the fake news. I need some good fake news here, so, but I don't know which one I'm talking about. It's a very crucial thing to our movement, your shows, the Ron Paul Institute, and you know, I watch YouTube videos and get great information from all kinds of people. Yeah, I think this is crucial, and as you say, it just goes. It's this kind of viral quality. So yeah, it's wonderful.
And Phil, I'll ask you a quick question. You spent decades in the intelligence community. You still know people there and have good contacts. You mentioned that they know what happened was very different than what we've been told is happening. If you could take a guess, what do you think is going on in the intelligence community right now as we sit here?
Well, I can't speak for the whole intelligence community, but I certainly can speak for the circle of people that I know that are retirees and some of whom are still, in fact, working on contract for the U.S. government. There's a great deal of dissent going on in terms of what is happening. This has been generated by the fact that, as I hinted at before, there are people inside the system who witnessed what happened 2 days ago and filmed it, saw it happening live from a drone, and they talked to their friends. And they say, look, what we saw, what we perceived, was precisely or was a lot closer to what the Russians are saying happened than what the White House is saying happened. I was personally astonished when President Trump immediately jumped on Syria. There was no way in hell that he could have known what he seemed to think he knew at that point. And Dad made the comment to me that basically he was getting his feed from what was going on in the mainstream media. In other words, he wasn't talking to his intelligence community, which could have given him possibly some reason to pause. Instead, he was listening to what Fox News was saying. So this is a very scary thing if we have a president who's driven more or less by what is perceived or is perceivable as factual information and is more driven by sentimental information that's being put out by the media, which is basically a commercial product trying to sell what it has and saying what it thinks will be most popular.
We have some questions out there from the audience. First hand went up in the back. You gotta catch this, though.
Right?
That's the key. If you don't, it's a mess.
Yeah, I have a question about the...
Okay.
All right, so can anybody hear me? Okay. I have a question about the concept of extreme vetting. In light of what is happening in Europe, is that a good thing to do extreme vetting? Or is this just a case of being xenophobic and paranoid?
Extreme vetting, again, is kind of a catchphrase. If you're opposed to it, you see it as an extremist act, and if you're in favor of it, you see it as something justifiable. I think the reality is that our immigration system, our refugee system, our asylum system, they're all connected, is broken. How do you tell that someone who comes from a war zone, who has no documents, who he is, what he's about, what he's doing? So when Donald Trump was raising these issues initially, they made a lot of sense. The problem is it then becomes dogma, it becomes doctrine, and the doctrine punishes the innocent together with the guilty without fixing the system. I would be much in favor of them looking for ways to fix the system rather than to punish people who might get caught up in it.
Norman? Conventional wisdom in D.C. on Thursday was that the Trump administration, with the allegations of the manufactured scandals of his connections to Putin and the failure to pass Obamacare repeal and replace, was causing his administration to flounder. Conventional wisdom on Friday morning was he was on the path to becoming the next Lincoln because he was killing a lot of children. To what extent do you think that those political considerations may have contributed to a wag the dog type scenario, at least in the Oval Office? And also, what does this mean between the reported conflict between Steve Bannon, the more nationalist populist America Firster, restrained foreign policy, and Rens Priebus and Trump's son-in-law, who represent more of a traditional establishmentarian rule the world and invade the world and invite the world point of view?
I agree. And I basically do agree with the premise of your questions, which all were aimed at, the things we've been talking about. I may kick this back to Phil if he wants to take that, or you, Dan.
Well, I was just going to say, there is a precedent when President Clinton got into trouble in a different sort of way, and the aspirin family factories in Sudan were taken out. So there certainly is a precedent for this sort of thing.
Is there any sense that this, in other words, if he was just reading the news and not resorting to intelligence, is there any way that was formulated, rounded, created that situation by the intelligence community?
I don't think it was created by the intelligence community. It was created by the White House. It's pretty clear. I think it is a plausible hypothesis that Trump would allow this to happen or encourage this to happen as a way of getting back at the Russiagate attacks against him by saying, look, I'm doing something against the Russians. I'm attacking their ally. It makes a lot of sense that he did that. And there are other elements of it that make sense to support that argument. For example, the Russians knew way in advance that this attack was coming. The U.S. had a hotline connected with Russian intelligence and told them an hour before the attack was coming. The Russians and the Syrians were able to more or less clear out the airbase, so it seems to have been an attack that was intended to minimize actual damage as a way to mitigate the reaction of the Russians. Now, that hasn't worked, as Dan pointed out. The Russians didn't buy into this. They're very offended by what occurred and what the implications of it are. So I think that, this may have been a clever, or as the English would put it, too clever by a half move on the part of the administration to deal with the Russiagate issue and to look tough at the same time. Unfortunately, the result has been both to strengthen the ISIS and the other terrorist groups in Syria, at the same time weaken the relationship with Russia, maybe in a fatal way. So
almost sounds like a $100 billion temper tantrum. Green box.
You might have partially answered my question already, but my question is, given all of the positive rhetoric between Trump, Putin, pre-election, and given the strategic importance of the negotiations with China and how the timing of the missiles coincided perfectly with China, do you think there was actually any kind of more backdoor, like you previously mentioned with Russia, where Trump is like, hey, if you kind of let me get away with a little missile strike to show a demonstration of strength against China, maybe I'll scratch your back in the future. Obviously, you have to trash talk it in the media, and you have to do your things and your PR, and then we have to do our PR, but ultimately let's not try to start World War III out of this. Let me get a little demonstration of strength against China, and maybe I'll just help you with Crimea or easing of sanctions down the road after this all kind of plays out. We get our cake with China. What's your thoughts on, I guess, all of that?
Well, I think I think that's a very possible scenario. And of course, we can't know. We don't have any information on this right now. And of course, the basic problem is that it's the president who is who came out as being, in a sense, kind of anti-interventionist, but never accepted the premise that I suppose most of us in this room accept, that you just shouldn't go looking for monsters. So I think that's what makes us have to ask all these, do all this specific speculation. It's like the old Sovietologist, you know, who sat outside of Red Square to see which lights were on in the Kremlin and things like that. You know, it's just it's speculation, but I think that sounds highly possible to me.
And my only problem with that is that the criminologists were usually wrong. So
it's absolutely true.
I worry about speculation on plausibilities, yeah. And I think oftentimes there's too much complexity put into the possibilities of these kinds of relationships.
And I would add that it's a very subtle scenario, and Trump doesn't do subtle very well.
Yeah, I have two short questions. One, Phil mentioned that we needed more whistleblowers, and I agree. And I'm wondering, hasn't been much talked about in the media about this, but I'm wondering, are contractors treated differently with results to the whistleblower statute? And then also, I was just wondering why we can't seem to get any, or why nobody in Congress in these intelligence communities seems to know anything about or can't get any documentation about what happened in various surveillance activities. It's like they're being stonewalled.
Yeah, well, two questions there. There's federal legislation for whistleblowers who are government employees. Whistleblower legislation is my understanding for people who are just employees of companies varies from state to state. I think that's the reality. So it would have to depend on what the law was in the state where the whistleblower's company was located. So it's not as easy for contractors, that's for sure. And what was the second question? Oh, yeah, got it, yeah, got it. Okay. As this was being debated on Thursday, they're debating in the Senate a resolution condemning Syria and calling for action. It was my understanding that the senators were not receiving any background information from the intelligence community. And the only reason I couldn't possibly understand why that was the case was because the White House must have been blocking it. Yeah, this is an awful situation where our elected representatives are not allowed to see the information that the government has when they're being called upon, basically, to agree with a document that's calling for possible acts of war. It's incredible.
Says that Putin hacked the election, Russian hacked the election. Well, what do they do? You know, and then when they're put into a corner, they say something vague like somehow RT mesmerized a middle America factory worker into voting for Trump. You know, when you pin them down, they can't point to what did the Russians do? Did they hack the ballot box? No, they didn't do that. We know they didn't do that. What did they do? Did they have Podesta's emails? Well, his password was password. So there wasn't a lot of geniuses. And then there's the CrowdStrike issue. The only organization that took the forensic evidence of the hacking turns out to be founded by a guy who has very shady circumstances, very closely tied to the Atlantic Council, which is a pro-let's-go-to-war Russia outfit, and also is on the payroll of the FBI.
Yeah, and the other thing I would point out when you talk about change of evidence, if a sophisticated intelligence service, which certainly the Russians had, was setting out to do this hack, to demoralize our democracy, to get Donald Trump elected, as all has been alleged and basically bought completely by the mainstream media, they would be able to hide their tracks. And they would, there are a number of things that they could do to get this information and to make sure that nobody would be able to pick up the trail as to where it finally went. So I'm not saying the Russians did it, but I'm saying if they did it, well, it's a waste of time to do an investigation. And that's why these investigations are such a frustrating thing. They're going to go on for months and months and months. All they're basically going to do is enfeeble the Trump administration, which after Thursday might be a good thing. But they're not going to accomplish anything.
Okay, let's go to Green.
A simple question. Why do we believe the North Koreans have nukes? All the tests so far have been well under critical mass. If you don't have 15 kilotons, you don't have critical mass, you didn't have a nuke. So why is it that we're believing these 1 kiloton tests, which could just as easily be fertilizer bombs?
The fact is, many people in the intelligence community don't believe that North Korea has a nuclear weapon. They believe, just as you are speculating, that the tests that the North Koreans have pointed to as evidence that they have these weapons were caused by conventional explosives or similar. And there are people that have been saying that and believe that. It's obviously in North Korea's interest to allege that it has nuclear weapons as a deterrent. So I think you have to pay your money and take your choice, but the U.S. government obviously has, by and large, bought into the theory that they do have nuclear weapons.
I think we have time for one more. I've got the blue in the corner.
Thanks for the panel, guys. I'm a PhD student, so my question is more about the role of academics and other pieces of the intelligentsia. How do you view both normatively and positively, so how you think it ought to be and how it just is right now, the role of academics and so-called the intellectual class with regard to the anti-war movement? Thank you.
Overwhelmingly still in academe, and especially in the disciplines, history and political science, foreign relations, sociology, these kinds of disciplines, people are financed by money that directs them in a certain way. For generations, the professors and the professoriate has been completely indoctrinated by stages as they go through graduate school. And so if you took the whole picture, it would look pretty grim. But on the other hand, most of these academics are pretty quiescent. They're busily investigating the dress links of dolls in 18th century New York or something, you know, that's not really that striking. So I think that there are a few academics who are really really effective, and some of them work in different kinds of institutions. Some of them are at high-profile research institutions, and some are not. But I think that, for example, if you go to one of the Mises economics conferences, you'll find that there are our fellow travelers everywhere throughout the discipline. So that too, I mean, I think it's a big uphill battle to think that you would ever convert that kind of mass and those kinds of years and generations of indoctrination, sort of the acceptance of social democracy, sort of the acceptance of Marxism light and and all of these kinds of things. But again, I see that in this case the glass is not at all half full, but there's something there in the glass anyway, and I think that that's still very useful to have.
I would just add to that put in a plug for the Ron Paul Institute's academic board. We have people like Professor Klaus Wren, who's dedicated his career to promoting a better foreign policy, a brilliant man, and also Professors Flint and Hillary Leverett. Flint is at University of Pennsylvania, and Hillary is at Teaching and American. They wrote a seminal work, Going to Tehran, which argued that we need a Nixon to China moment to have an opening with Iran, which to his credit is something that President Obama did to the consternation of almost everyone in Washington. So they get credit for that. And I think we're going to have to close out the panel, but thank you very much to the panelists, Bill Giraldi, Professor Antulli. Thank you so much for joining us.
I hesitate to introduce the next speaker because he's been such a friend and mentor to me. I don't think I can be objective, but Lou Rockwell, we share some things in common. We both worked in Ron Paul's congressional office, so we kind of feel like alumni. As a matter of fact, I do have ronpaulalumni.org. I just haven't done anything with it, but there are a lot of people that went through that office. Lou was so instrumental in bringing me to the non-interventionist movement. I first started reading him when President Clinton was bombing Serbia, and I knew that it was wrong, and I found Lou Rockwell and Justin Raimondo, and they really led me in the direction that I ended up, and so I'm so grateful. And Lou was instrumental in convincing me to suggest to Dr. Paul that upon his retirement, we look for ways to continue his foreign policy legacy, and so I'm eternally grateful for Lou. Ladies and gentlemen, Lou Rockwell.
Daniel, thank you, and I might say that it's an honor that we're co-sponsoring this conference today with the Ron Paul Institute. This is the first time in the entire history of the Mises Institute, as David Stockman asked me the other night, I said, have you ever done this before? I said, no, and David said, well, with these two organizations together, he said, I knew I had to be there. So all these speakers, of course, are just tremendous. The speech that I had originally planned became very quickly out of date. So I think I'm just going to take questions and answers today. I might just talk for a moment about how far back some of these problems go. When we hear the word national security, national interest, used by people in Washington, I always think it's important to substitute imperial for national. Then it all makes sense. So was it in the national interest of the United States to bomb Syria? No, it wasn't. Was it in the imperial interest of the American Empire to do so? Yes, very much so. Because every little jot and tittle on the map of the world might threaten the empire, since the U.S. feels, as the Romans did before them, and others, of course, besides the Romans, that really the U.S. is destined to rule the world. In the U.S.'s case, I guess, rule the solar system, too. With the colonies on Mars and the moon and so forth. So everything is of interest to them. Everything is important. And just as the state, even a dictatorial state, and by the way, the American president counts as a dictator if we were to judge him by the standards of the founding fathers. We call all these other guys dictators. To the founders, one of the key things about a tyrant was that he was able to declare war on his own. So, of course, we've had that for some time in this country. So the Romans were famous for their slogan, divide et impera, divide and conquer. We can put it in a more modern context, bring about chaos and control. An empire, whether it was the Roman Empire or the American Empire or all the other empires, benefits from causing trouble. It prevents people from coalescing against it, keeps everybody off their feed. Everybody wondering what the heck is going to happen next if they're in some part of the world where they might be attacked, being constantly subverted by the CIA and the other, all the other intelligence agencies, which feel that is, you know, when we hear about the Russians faking news and so forth to control our elections, the CIA and the other intelligence agencies always intervene in other people's elections, always. We know about all the covert agencies. There's even an overt agency, the National Endowment for Democracy, whose open job is to interfere in other countries' elections to bring about democracy. Well, what is democracy? The democratic result is when the pro-American side wins, the side that is therefore that is going to be subservient to the U.S. empire. That's democracy. So we have an open organization. I never heard that mentioned, just strangely enough, during all the talk about the poor Russians. So the Romans, Schumpeter points this out in one of his articles on ancient Rome, that they had two, in the official propaganda, there were two themes. We are the most important. We bring civilization. We bring culture. We bring law. We are the greatest people ever to exist. We're destined, in fact, by the gods to rule forever. That's why Rome was called the Eternal City. Turned out not to be eternal, but that's what they felt. That's what they propagandized as. On the other hand, there was a constant drumbeat of, oh my gosh, the Germans are going to get us. The Gauls are going to get us. The whomevers are going to get us. Keep the people constantly in fear of being attacked. While the Romans, of course, were attacking everybody else. Garrett Garrett, the great old right journalist in the years before World War II, referred to America as having this complex of fear and vaunting. That is, we're the best, we're the most powerful, we're the richest, we're the greatest, we're the freest. USA number one, you know, and the finger and all that. Meanwhile, oh my gosh, they're going to get us. The Germans are going to get us. The Japanese are going to get us. The Russians are going to get us, whatever. There's always some enemy. The terrorists are going to get us. So it's important that it's exactly the same story as the Romans. And part of this, it's always interested me as to who they're demonizing. When a country is being demonized, when a foreign leader is being demonized, and are these guys dictators? Are they dictators by founding father standards? Oh, yeah. Is the American president, again, a dictator by the founding father standards? Oh, yes. And in fact, he's the world dictator, not just a dictator of one regime. So I think it's always important to look at the people who are being demonized. Remember when Saddam Hussein was being demonized. And by the way, this was a very bad man. He actually, at U.S. behest, by the way, I should mention he was installed by the U.S. in power, the U.S. and the British, as the anti-communist dictator of Iraq, because they were concerned about having, of course, an Iraq that would be friendly to British then and U.S. interests. But he did something very, very evil. He started a war against Iran in which a million people were killed on both sides. And he received chemical weapons from the U.S. He received intelligence. He received vast amounts of money, weapons. And it was a horrible thing he did. On the other hand, he's an interesting character. I remember just before the second Iraq war, when Michael Moore actually did something good. I know that's a little bit difficult to believe. He put out a movie called Fahrenheit 9/11. And I remember it being bitterly criticized at the time because he showed regular scenes of Iraq. He showed businesses. He showed mothers taking their children to the playground. He showed the a very popular National Symphony Orchestra in Baghdad, men and women, no women wearing burqas or scarves, by the way. If they wanted to, they could. They didn't have to. Playing classical music. Showed companies, showed businesses. Notice how many pictures have you seen of Damascus? We're never shown pictures or anything that humanizes any country the U.S. has got in the crosshairs. So Saddam Hussein, I don't know, I always thought it was interesting that when he knew he was going to be attacked, he opened all the collections of weapons of the government and handed them out to anybody who wanted them. And I thought, well, that's an unusual thing for a dictator to do. He was pro-Christian, something else that Assad is guilty of. He protected the Christians. He was from a minority tribe, which is typically how these countries work when you've got huge splits between tribes of Sunnis and Shias and tribes not entirely, there are many tribes within both these groups. It's a very complex picture. So he was always in a balancing act. But part of the balancing act, and I don't think it was out of the goodness of his heart, although it, who knows, he was pro-Christian. He prevented the Christians from being being ethnically cleansed and killed, as has happened ever since the U.S. intervened in Iraq, maybe just by coincidence, maybe not by coincidence. I always thought it was interesting. I couldn't watch the whole thing, but there was famously a tape made of Saddam Hussein's execution. And as he's walking to the gallows where he's going to be, hanged, he was very calm, dignified, and I thought at the time, I wonder if George Bush, in a similar circumstance, would be calm and dignified as he's about to be executed. So it's just an interesting point that doesn't seem to go along with what we're told about Assad. I've always thought it was interesting that Assad did not want to be in politics. He was educated in England in ophthalmology. He was a practicing ophthalmologist in London. Left Syria, and it was only the death of his older brother in a car accident, and his father's pleading that brought him back. And I think he must often wish the heck he were still an ophthalmologist in London, because of course he's being threatened with being Qaddafiized, and he has a beautiful family. They would all be killed as well. But he's a very interesting figure. Do you ever see him? Are there any? One time there were a few interviews with him. Why aren't there interviews with him? Why isn't he allowed to speak his piece? Never. Why aren't there pictures of what life is like in the areas of Syria that have not been destroyed by the U.S. or by its, how shall I say, cohorts, ISIS and Al-Qaeda? Very, very suspicious relationship between the U.S. and ISIS and Al-Qaeda. Mujahideen, as was pointed out earlier, were in effect Al-Qaeda, financed by the U.S., brought together by the U.S. to fight the Russians in Afghanistan. This is where Osama bin Laden first came to prominence, and his role in that fight. So empires are happy, maybe all governments, being not being a pro-government guy myself, maybe all governments are happy to employ these kinds of evil forces to bring about the chaos that then enables them to go say, hey, we're bringing civilization. We're the ones. And you can trust us. Turns out, of course, you can't trust the U.S. We can't trust the U.S. government ever. We can't trust the U.S. government domestically because it aims to destroy every institution that stands against it, whether it's the family, the community, the business, the charity, the church. Government is against them all. That ought to give us a clue about what's going on in the rest of the world. You just can't trust them. You can't believe them. And it's always important not to believe them. I always love the old British expression, never believe anything until it's been officially denied. Maybe sometimes government officials and politicians tell the truth. I exempt, of course, Ron Paul, who was the great truth teller. So these are very interesting times. What Trump did is unfortunately, obviously not what he promised in his election. Was it entirely a fraud? One of my favorite bloggers, Bionic Mosquito, said, did he wake up with a horse's head in his bed? You know, what exactly happened? He also said he was turned by the deep state even faster than Reagan, and he said this time they didn't have to use a bullet. So Reagan became very compliant. I don't think Reagan actually had some interesting ideas about the gold standard and other things that just immediately disappeared after he was shot. Trump has been conquered again, or was he? Was it always, you know, who knows? We'll see. Maybe there's still some good that, to be had there. He's already done some, a few good regulatory things, but most of it, of course, has been bad. But all the U.S. presidents, when was the last time we had a half-decent U.S. president? Herbert Hoover was a great man of peace, post-World War II, for example, tried to bring about peace during his administration, but a total disaster as president domestically. He was really responsible for the start of the New Deal. Roosevelt just continued his work, Hoover's work, which was based on Woodrow Wilson's work, setting up the, really the first fascist economy in American history, made perpetual by Franklin Roosevelt during his administration. So we can't trust these people. So let me just end there and see if any of the bouncing balls want to ask a question here. Yes.
Hello.
Yes, sir.
We all know the UN has never met a foreign invasion they didn't approve of, but the European Union hasn't really fully jumped on board with it yet. How do you think their role will play out as this continues?
Well, the European Union was a very interesting organization, as we now know, set up at least at the behest of, or certainly with the cooperation and the urging of the CIA. Maybe it was more than that. On the other hand, U.S. opposition has kept them from having their own army and their own military otherwise, which I think is a benefit. But on the other hand, you have NATO vastly expanded. NATO not there. Mr. Trump, when he talks about, hey, they owe us more money than we're spending too much money defending them. Obviously, the U.S. is not defending anybody in Europe. The U.S. is occupying Europe. The U.S. got atomic bombs all over Germany. If your next door neighbor has got an atomic bomb in your backyard and he asked you for something, you may be inclined to do it. So the EU, I must say I despise the EU, I hate the EU, I hope it goes out of existence. But I think there are some pro-peace people in Europe, not the evil Angela Merkel or Juncker or the rest of the people in the belly of the beast, the direct belly of the beast. But the Europeans have been hurt by the U.S. anti-Russian sanctions, dramatically hurt. Businesses in Germany and France, all over Europe, which used to do a tremendous amount of very profitable business with the Russians, have been hurt. And there, as a result, there's pressure against that. On the other hand, they must be afraid themselves of being bombed if were they to remove the sanctions. And this, of course, was put on during the Obama administration, and quite terrible. Sanctions, as Ron Paul reminds us, are only, of course, not a violation of free trade, not only a violation of free trade, but they're acts of war under international law. It's an act of war. I mean, those of us old enough to remember the boycott, the oil boycott in the 70s, people were very angry. They were angry at the countries that were doing that because it had a bad effect here. Now, the real reason it had a bad effect here was the U.S. government, which set up the rationing scheme that ended up with, I was living in Oklahoma City at that time, ended up with Oklahoma City being awash in gasoline, I'm not complaining about that, and other parts of the country, you know, having none. Of course, it was a crazy quilt and a horrible system, but everybody was angry at those Arabs who had caused this. Well, at the worst thing, if the Arabs had simply asking more money for their oil, it would have raised the price here, but it would not have led to a shortage. Anytime there's a shortage of anything, it means the government is involved. As Murray Rothbard used to say, there's no shortage of Rembrandts. If you want to buy a Rembrandt, you can buy a Rembrandt. You've got to have the market price, obviously. So, but sanctions make people very angry, rightly angry. They seek to impoverish people. They're immoral. It's an attack on civilians. If we think of the most rigorous of the just war criterion, that war was supposed to be what Mises said, it was supposed to be a war of the soldiers. It was not supposed to involve civilians. Now, of course, in all wars, civilians are the vast majority of the dead and wounded. Vast majority. In a lot of these countries, it's far safer to be a soldier than to be a civilian. Is this by happenstance? No, I don't think it is. I think it's deliberate. Hans Hoppe would tell us that it has to do with the emergence of democratic war in World War I and the rest, and really starting with the American Civil War. Lincoln began it all, like so much other evil stuff. And Wilson and the British picked it up. The British, of course, always being, if anything, worse than the U.S. as imperialists and spies and so forth. But the idea that really everybody is a legitimate target. If you're working in a factory, you might be making munitions. If you're delivering milk, why you're enabling the workers of munitions, the makers of munitions and so forth, so that everybody can be killed. And in fact, as during World War II, the U.S. engaged in massive bombing of all cities of Germany and Japan, deliberately killing millions of civilians. Collateral damage, you know, those are just words. So I hope the people of the EU, the good people of the EU, and there are many great people, and the wonderful movements that are against the EU and tend to be peace movements. I was very glad to see Nigel Farage, the great leader of Brexit, condemn this attack on Syria. And that's the way I think a lot of, according to the London Telegraph, that's the view of all the right-wing populists, so-called, in Europe. They don't like war. They don't like intervention. They really have many libertarian things about them. So there's always hope, but there's only hope in saying no, in thinking no, in withholding your consent from these people, not in worshiping the military, not in worshiping the agencies of government, not in worshiping the government, not in worshiping politicians. We have to withdraw, withhold, create our own values based on our own religions, our own love of freedom, and not pay any attention. I don't say there's anything wrong with watching the media, although I was influenced some years ago by a great article that argued that watching Fox lowered your IQ. But of course, if you watch these channels and you believe them, certainly your stock of knowledge is devalued and lowered, of actual knowledge. Because of course, they're all fake news. It's supposed to be, I was very glad to have LouRockwell.com put on the list of fake news sites, the 200 fake news sites. But fake news is stuff the government doesn't want you to hear. Government doesn't want you to believe these things. You're not supposed to read it. And we have Google and Facebook, of course, cooperating with the suppression of this so-called fake news. And on the other hand, as Daniel pointed out, there still is great things going on among young people and among social media. I'm told, I did not see this myself, that trending on Twitter, number one yesterday and today, was the hashtag Fire Jared Kushner. So that's not exactly, of course, the kind of thing we hear in public. And I don't think we should maybe draw any conclusions from the fact that Mr. Kushner, the son-in-law and most powerful advisor to President Trump, owns an office building at 666 Fifth Avenue. So interesting. Sorry, any more? Oh, Professor Butler Schaefer?
Your concluding remarks that reminded me of the old Eisenhower-Stevenson presidential. They weren't debates, they were just speeches. And they were being shown at a particular mental hospital, and the hospital custodians had to turn them off because it was so upsetting to the patients. I've really been interested in this division, or not division, the contrast between individual thinking and the kind of collective groupthink that has been alluded to today. And I think that the strength of either of these approaches, individual thought versus group thought, either create civilizations or destroys them, and I think that may be where we are right now. Randolph Bourne addressed this, I think, when he talked about the power of war to transform individual thinking into the advocacy of policies and programs none of them would think of doing individually. And when there's talk that began, I think, with the Clinton administration and carried over into the Bush administration about impeachment, I did an article suggesting that maybe it's the American people that should be impeached because they haven't really performed the task, which I think is a burden upon all of us, to question those who would presume to rule us. I have long been of the view that people, men and women, have a moral duty to prevent their children from being ruled by tyrannies. I was wondering if you have any thought on that.
Well, I couldn't agree with you more, and I just you reminded me of a point that the late Joe Sobrin made when he was opposing the war in Iraq. He said, imagine that they would put a 7-year-old Iraqi little girl on television and say, what we're going to do is we're going to stab her to death. If you are willing to go to war, this is going to be the start. And of course, everybody would be horrified. How could you say such a thing? What a horrible event. And yet, of course, there were going to be so many thousands, perhaps hundreds of thousands of Iraqi little girls who died through the American sanctions and then through the wars. 500,000, if we remember, Iraqi children died because of the sanctions and the evil Secretary of State. Albright was asked about it, and she said, we think it's worth it. And I thought, you... Yeah. Yeah. Especially because Mrs. Albright could use a little sanctions herself, I must say. And
do we have time, David, for one more question?
One more question? Okay.
Lou, several times in your remarks, you mentioned the word chaos. I think it was very appropriately mentioned. In this environment where we're inundated daily with the competing propaganda from very skilled propaganda machines, the search for truth becomes very difficult. You mentioned several years ago in a Mises Circle event a story that came out of the Soviet Union in its waning years about a party official who was traveling through the countryside in his big car, had a flat. And the locals tried to help him fix the flat, open the trunk, salamis all over the place. They couldn't get those. They almost beat him to death or something like that.
Yeah.
You mentioned that in our time, the internet may serve that same purpose as the salamis in that trunk. What do you think currently about the possibility? The internet is so full now of competing propaganda. The search for truth is difficult.
It is, but
you can update us on your opinion.
But the internet has made it possible. I'll tell you, it was very, very difficult before the internet. You had to have access to a big international newsstand, for example, in your city where you could get foreign papers and foreign publications, some of which you could subscribe to. No way in heck you could afford to subscribe to all of them. And you had American publications, but they tended to be very obscure. So it was much. Now it's much easier. So it's still very difficult. But I'll just mention the great Eric Margolies, who tragically couldn't be here for illness reasons for this conference. But he has a very interesting column today on LouRockwell.com called "Bomb the Usual Arabs," and in it he talks about. He thinks that at least part of what was going on, and this has been mentioned earlier too, was the humiliation of President Xi of China. Here he is arriving at Mar-a-Lago, I guess we have to call it War-a-Lago now, to have dinner, which is already, he's in a supplicant position that he's doing that. And then he's totally humiliated by his ally, Syria. Can't forget, China is an ally of Syria too. Margolies says, Trump is lucky he didn't just leave, take his plane back and go because of this horrendous insult to him. So this was an insult. This is, again, all part of the imperial strategy
of there are really only two countries in the world that don't bow to the U.S., that don't bow the knee to the U.S., at least on some things. That's Russia and China. So who are the two places we're supposed to hate? Who are the two places we're supposed to be ready to go to war for? Eric points out we're supposed to go to war with China because they've turned some atolls in the South China Sea into military bases. He said, how is that any different from the U.S. aircraft carriers patrolling those same areas that are all, just in effect, roving military bases? Some years ago, I saw an article by Bill Kristol denouncing the Chinese. He said the Chinese seek to be the important power in the South China Sea. I thought, that's pretty horrible. It's like somebody accusing the U.S. of seeking to be the major power in the Gulf of Mexico. But of course, if you understand that according to the official ideology, we are the exceptional nation, not only with the greatest, the best, the richest, and all the rest of it, even though, of course, a lot of that's not true. The rules don't apply to us. In fact, not only do the rules not apply to us, we make the rules. We impose the rules, and you better obey. So China and Russia are not obeying, therefore they must be crushed. Both these, of course, countries have thermonuclear weapons, and it's really why this is a very scary thing. Thank God for Ron Paul, who's our next speaker. What do you say about Ron Paul? A man of transparent goodness, honesty, and decency, which is really the bedrock, I think, of everything he's done. Even those who don't agree with him, even those who dislike his principles, respect him. That was even true in the House of Representatives, although I think something that helped Ron a lot and gain respect from even all the creeps in Congress was he was such a great athlete. So they knew him in the gym, and they knew what an impressive guy he was as an athlete. Still is, by the way. Still goes on tremendous bike rides and swims every single day. And that's also a bedrock of his personality. He's an athlete. He's an intellectual. He's a physician, of course. He's a scientist. He's a historian. He's an economist. He's a man who has never violated his principles, ever. As I can testify, was never even tempted to violate his principles, no matter what might seem to have been the political benefit, no matter what the pressure. I was honored to be in Ron's office when the incident that Jeff describes, when the White House called to have Reagan personally arm twist Ron. He learned, like everybody else in Washington, you can't twist Ron Paul's arm. He's got untwistable arms. And they never could do it. There was an incident in the House Republican caucus where one of the secret meetings that Congressman Massey was talking about, where Newt Gingrich is giving some horrible orders to support a massive budget deficit, I believe it was. And he's telling everybody that's like a triple line whip. You must all vote, you're going to all vote, and so forth. And then he said, of course, what I'm saying doesn't apply to Ron Paul. He knew Ron Paul couldn't be threatened, couldn't be persuaded by all the emoluments and other gifts that could have been his had he been willing to sell out. So he has such tremendous moral stature, and his early support was essential to the early flourishing of the Mises Institute. We're so honored to have him on our board. We obviously are strong admirers of the Ron Paul Institute for Peace and Prosperity, and of all the work Ron has done his entire life for the cause of freedom, for the cause of prosperity, for the cause of peace. And as we live in a world today, as has happened in the past, where maybe we're actually threatened by a chance of a full-blown world war, how blessed we are to have him here today, how blessed we are all to have his voice speaking out through the Ron Paul Liberty Report and all the media appearances he does through his writings, calling for sanity, calling for decency, calling for the Prince of Peace to be listened to. Just one more story, when Ron was talking to the Values Voters Summit, which is the alleged Christian voters, and he told them that his foreign policy was based on his worship of the Prince of Peace. They told him that when they, what they thought of that, they all almost seemed to me unanimously booed him, loudly booed him, and I thought, you know, so Christians booing the Prince of Peace, well, I guess that's politics for you. But not Ron Paul. So please help me welcome really the greatest American, our leader, Dr. Ron Paul.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Well, before I get started, I need to announce that we have somebody with us today who is the head of the Paul household. That is my wife, Carol. And also, it was mentioned that Lou and Daniel spent some time at the congressional office, but we also know that Norm Singleton spent some time there, and he's the president of the Campaign for Liberty. And also Jeff, I believe, he spent some time there, and they're all doing great things as soon as they got out of Washington, and they continued. So it is wonderful. But it's also very nice to be able to visit with a friend, David Stockman. We knew each other early on and did some work in the Congress, but then he got busy and he went off to, for fortune and fame. But just in recent years now, we've become reacquainted and working together. And David, it's been great to see you again, and glad you came to visit with us today. But I want to welcome everybody to this metropolis of Lake Jackson. I mean, this is fantastic. And also, you know, I'm very particular about our crowds. You know, I go where the young people are, and I am just so glad that here's another college crowd and young people are here, so welcome to the program. But I do speak to young people, but I assume we're all young people because liberty is a young idea. It's really not something that has been around for thousands and thousands of years, and the benefits of liberty have been rather recent. I think of the Industrial Revolution as a consequence of an understanding about economic liberty and the tremendous advancements that have existed with the Industrial Revolution. But I've always wondered, well, why don't we advance in the social revolution? Why, if we learn how to build so many wonderful things and the standard of living goes up for so many people, we have all these luxuries, why is it that we haven't figured it out how to stay out of killing each other? So at the same time, we've had all this advancement that helped us in technological things in the Industrial Revolution. We've had more killing than ever before. Just think of the 20th century with all that advancement. I can't help but think about my dad talking to me about when his dairy started, the family dairy started, he delivered milk in a horse and buggy, you know, horse and wagon. And that was at the beginning of the last century. So it's so recent, and yet we haven't advanced very much in this social sphere of how do we get along with people. And I'm an optimist because I believe we should be able to do that. And when you look at the history of mankind, it's really so very young, especially if you decide to figure what part of the existence of the universe, the solar system, have mankind existed. You know, it's not even hardly a drop in the bucket of or the drop in the ocean. It's such a short period of time, and most of the advancement has been in the last 300 years, and there's some significant events that have occurred there, especially, you know, with our revolution. There was an emphasis on individual liberty, and there were changes, but there's something that comes up short on why we don't do a better job in avoiding the wars. Besides, I have a conviction about you know, what we're talking about, and that is peace. And I think peace is popular. very popular, not just among us, but I think with all people. But then the big question is if peace is popular and people really want it, why are there so many wars? And that's really a serious question about what is going on, especially when I go to the campuses and talk to the young people. They're not saying, yeah, let's have another war. We like to go off and get exposed to the killing, and we want all the debt to deal with, and we want to deal with inflation. No, that group of individuals generally are less pro-war than the rest. I can remember one time when I made a charge that this particular piece of legislation was pro-war, and it was on the side of the Republicans that were promoting this piece of legislation. And boy, I had one ex-government military official come up to me. He was so annoyed. He said, "I am not pro-war." You know, they don't see themselves that way, and yet they are pro-war. But if I had to look back and guess on the number of people I've met throughout my lifetime, you know, from grade school on up, and the many people I've met in the last 15 or 20 years in politics, tens of thousands and exposed to hundreds of thousands of people, and I would say that 90% of the people that I come into contact with are really pro-peace, and peace is what they want. Then why is it if 90% of the people really want to live in peace, why don't we live in peace? 10% of the bad people have a greater influence than 90%. And in some ways, that is the case. Our problem is not so much the people become supportive of war or promote the war. Too many of them are very apathetic and complacent. They go along. But the big problem is that the people, the citizens, the people who suffer from the war, don't start the war. The real problem is that we have to understand it's the government and government policies that causes the war, and that's what we have to restrain. So I think what happens, governments have been around for a long time, is that people who have psychopathic personalities and aggressive personalities and enjoy telling other people how to live, whether it's in a social sense, economic sense, or in a military sense, they like power. And there's an opening, and people don't the people themselves don't have a resistance, and governments tend to have, over the centuries, always assumed a lot more power. And this just opens up the door for the people who want power, and even those who go with good intentions to Washington, they are consumed with this attitude, and before you know it, they're part of the system. There have been so many individuals that I've seen over the years who had very good intentions about going to Washington, and they believe basically like we do, but they didn't maintain that position. They're not like the few that stick to their principles. So they go, and then they're influenced, and all of a sudden, you know, the whole system is political. For them to do good and promote our views, they have to be in a position of power and influence in Washington. So they succumb to become more moderate and say, well, I have to give in. The one term I don't like is moderation in politics, because I think that is a sacrifice of principles. What I like to think about in politics as far as making corrections, because there's so much imperfections, is to work with coalitions. And that is, there are a lot of people that might not be true libertarians, but they have a set of principles that they'd like to see a lot less killing and a lot less war, and there's no reason in the world we can't be talking as I do to the Dennis Kuciniches of the world and others who will stand up, you know, for peace. And this to me, I think, is real the answer. Moderates, when they come together, they have to sacrifice what they believe in. You know, let's say you have a liberal in the negative sense and conservatives in the negative sense, but each having some positive things, and they come together, but they have to give up, you know, their beliefs. So they sacrifice their true conviction. Now, when I think of the relationship I've had with Dennis Kucinich, We never ask each other to sacrifice anything. We ignore the things that we disagree with, and we come together on the issues that we do agree with, and we work in that capacity. But that helps a little bit. But why is it that we still keep losing the battle? Well, the one thing is I am convinced the libertarian principle can solve a lot of problems. If we would adapt to the principle of non-aggression, not initiating any force against each other, and we had people really accept this, it can solve so many problems, social problems, economic problems, peace problems, and everything else. But if we do that, the big problem is, as soon as they get into government, the government doesn't have to obey the same rules. And we can't, with the libertarian principle, although I have such strong positive feeling about this principle, that one thing it can't solve is the problem of good and evil. You know, Adam said that, you know, we the founders have given you a republic if you can keep it. And he said that the moral standings of the people will make the difference. When the people become immoral, the system just doesn't work. And yet at the same time, if the people who are immoral, the problem is they get in government. So our job is first, if we can't solve the problem of good and evil, some people call me naive because I'm too optimistic about how people should act if they would just accept a few principles. But I think good and evil is going to exist, and the evil people are going to be out there. So the big challenge for us is, of course, to keep the evil people out of government. You know, that's where the problem comes from. But I think the founders tried to do that. They tried to set up the rules, and yet there's always this temptation, the temptation of power corrupting. And they get in office, and they give in, and they move over, and they sacrifice. And so I think the founders basically failed. If they had been successful, our Constitution would be a much more powerful instrument. And it didn't take a long time to have some early erosion. As a matter of fact, I think Jefferson realized that early on, that there was an erosion. And even those who said be careful about the Constitutional Convention and cautious about opening up the door to the growth of government, and that has happened. So the individuals, you know, sacrifice too much and allow governments to do this. So how are we, you know, if people were alert, we would only send the very good people who would not be tempted to do bad things in Washington. We wouldn't send the bad people, and we wouldn't send people who would succumb to the temptation. But that doesn't seem to have worked as well. So it's back to the problem of how do we limit the government. I think the key to it is to have a set of rules that are more binding, but it has to be supported by the people. What should the role of government be? And that is the question. I think the founders asked that, and they tried to redefine it. But I think we have to ask that question and try to define what should the role of government be. I have a very complicated answer to what the role of government ought to be. The role of government and the purpose of government should be to protect liberty. That's it. And that's what our goal should be. So of course, what would be the step there? Well, we have to repeal 87%. I just picked that out of the air. 87% of what our federal government does, because you wouldn't need all this stuff, because what government does, whether it's economic intervention, running monetary policy, regulatory things that are always supposed to help the people and take care of the consumers, or a foreign policy and making the world safe for democracy and spread American exceptionalism, you know, that can't work. You have to have a system where the government is strictly limited. What would it mean? It would mean that, first off, we should be able to absolutely have a position in a country like ours that a very powerful right, and I put it in quotes, an ability for the organization such as the states, that are put together for our country, they should always have the right to secede. Now, does that mean we have to be for secession and every state has to leave? Well, right now it'd be hard for me to deny anybody's right to leave, but you don't have to. It's just the right to secede that is so important. That would hold the federal government in check. The government would have to be careful. But even if they just had nullification, which was a strong issue of Jefferson, just so we as a people and the local people and local governments, the state government, if you didn't like what the feds were doing, and if they're violating the Constitution, that you ought to be able to opt out and nullify it. And that would hold a big check on the federal government as well. And the neat part about this is it's coming, because we are going to have chaos. We're going to have economic chaos. We're going to have the political fallout of our foreign interventionism. The world will turn against us, and we are going to have an opportunity for a lot of nullification. It's already starting. I think it's fantastic that the issue of the ridiculous war on drugs is coming to an end, because the states and the people are nullifying these laws and they're saying stay away. I hope that doesn't get reversed with this administration, but at least we're making progress there, and I think that is great. And we have groups of people now, and I just recently was out in Arizona because they're passing a bill out there, and it's very popular, trying to follow the Constitution on the money issue, because the directive is to the states. The states are not allowed to use anything other than gold and silver as legal tender. So who broke the law? The government broke the law. They were explicit in the Constitution that you can't counterfeit. You can't debase the currency, and they were very explicit on this. But we're not allowed to debase the currency, but the government is, and that is why this principle that if you and I can't do something, the basic Bastiat principle, if you and I can't steal from people, we can't debase the currency, and we can't rob and kill and do all these things, why in the world have we allowed our governments to do that? We have to curtail that power. So if we just can't go out, you know, just killing people because it's against the law, it's immoral, why do we allow our governments to do this constantly with bombs and missiles and threats and boycotts and all the things that we do? We have to be able to apply these basic principles that have been understood, but it's turned out that our governments did this to hold us in check, to say, you can't do this, you can't do this, and if you bend the rules, we're going to get you. But they're exempt, and this sucks into people who love that power. And the people are too lackadaisical, and they're too apathetic. One of the signs during the campaign that I loved, because they would put a sign up, Ron Paul cured my apathy. And I took it as a compliment, because I think that is what we need. We need to get rid of the apathy. We need to stand up and be engaged. And a lot of people say, well, you know, what should I do? What should I do? I said, do it. Do whatever you want to do, but just do something. But Leonard Reed, who was somebody that I admired at the Foundation for Economic Education, he says, our first responsibility, and I took this seriously in the 50s when I started looking at these issues, he says, you got to understand the issues. You got to know how to explain these things the best you can do. And I feel like I keep trying to do better in explaining all the issues. And he said, then what do I do? He says, don't worry about it. His answer to the crowds would be, then don't worry about it. If you know the issues and you want to be involved, and he says, somebody will find you. Fortunately, we found Lou Rockwell, and he started the Mises Institute. I mean, this is what we need. And somebody else must have been awfully bored. He says, I'm going to do something. I'm going to vote for Ron Paul no matter what, and Bill Green actually did. He gave us a vote. So no, everybody has a responsibility, and I've often talked about the responsibility of us as individuals, because I consider this an exceptional audience. I think that we need 8% of the population to really change the world, not 51%, 8% to lead the charge. And I think in a group like this, you all belong to that 8%. So that is the goal, is for the 8% to be identified. Right now, there's an 8%, and they're in charge. And that's our big problem, and they just are running roughshod over us. But I see a lot of positive things happening. I see it on the campuses. Believe me, I do not believe that Bernie Sanders owns the campuses. He might own the professors and a few other people who are preaching all this, Marxism, cultural Marxism, and they're present, but that's a different story. I meet too many young people on the campuses that are very much involved. Take, for instance, the Young Americans for Liberty was an outgrowth of our first presidential campaign. They have over 900 chapters of YAL chapters in colleges around the country now. Thomas Massey, he left here earlier because he's on his way to Denver to talk to a YAL chapter. So, and they're enthusiastic and they're very good. So there's a lot of things. The ideas have to change first. And people keep thinking, well, how are we in the campaign? Well, how are we going to change the Republican Party? It's totally irrelevant, you know, and it's totally irrelevant for that matter for the Libertarian Party. And it's irrelevant with the Democratic Party. It doesn't even count. What really counts is what is the understanding? What have they learned? What is liberty all about? And that's where the progress is. Because I think that we have institute like the Mises Institute, but there are others out there. There's a bunch of people doing this, and the attitudes are changing. I think it's somewhat like it was in the 1930s. Do you know Roosevelt? If we were living and voting in 1932, I think a lot of us would have been tempted to vote for Roosevelt. He was for the gold standard, balanced budget, low taxes, and the whole thing is. But he must have been very knowledgeable by fake news and fake stories, because he was lying through his teeth, especially when he was going to keep us out of war. But behind the scenes, the universities they were introducing the Keynesian philosophy. We're not going to advocate ruthless communism, but Mises was very clear. He said that socialism, the whole principle of socialism in government controls, will fail. And of course he did. He wouldn't have been a bit surprised about 89 and 90 to see the collapse of communism. So he also had an opinion about interventionism. Interventionism is a term I like to use a lot, because I don't want the government to intervene in your personal life. As long as you don't hurt anybody, it's your business what religion you have, or if you don't have a religion. And that is why libertarianism, so you bring all kinds of people together with different views. Religion doesn't matter. Bring them together. And one form of government that I like the least is the theocracies. And I'm a religious person, but I don't want a theocracy. And certainly, we don't want our governments telling other countries what to do, even when they're imperfect. One time we had this debate, it was an anti-China discussion even 10, 15 years ago, and they wanted to punish. Well, we can't do that until they prove they're not violating civil liberties in China. I said, how about protecting civil liberties here at home? You know, that's our responsibility. So there's a lot of good things happening, and I think in the 30s, guess what? The old right, there were a few, they grew even more as time went on, and fortunately there was a group that held it together through the late 30s and the 40s and in the 50s, but you know, the interventionists, they won out cold. They took over the universities. They took over the media. And it was a way that they could get power, the same type of individual, you know, the psychopathic personality that feels like they are the elitist and they know how to run the world. They won. And but right now, I believe it's been reversed. I think there's more and more people now advancing to this other newer stage where libertarian ideas are so attractive, and the chaos is going to be so bad that there's going to be an opening for us. And that is why all of us have a responsibility. I am convinced in my own mind, this is very personal, that because you are more knowledgeable and more understanding and more anxious to help, you come to events like this, you help the Mises Institute, you help the Ron Paul Institute, and you promote these causes, and you're well-educated in this field, I think you have a greater moral responsibility if you look at it, because you know the masses out there, they're apathetic, and it's hard to stir them. We just need to get them apathetic enough that they won't resist us, and we get 51% to endorse us is what we want. You do need their endorsement. The masses have to endorse the ideas. But I think it's I think it's just fantastic what is really happening. But the responsibility, you say, still say, what do I do? Well, figure it out. There's something to do. And like Leonard Reed said, we have to be well-informed, self-informed, know what's going on, and keep studying and try to answer the question. The jobs will come along. And to me, it's amazing. I go around the country, and there's so many people have, started different organizations. Some run for office, but I've not been overly enthusiastic about that. They'll come and say, all right, you've convinced me, so I want to go to Congress like you did. I said, they'll say, what should I do? And he's be, a college kid or something. I said, don't do it. But that doesn't mean I'm not for it. It's just I wanted to have them hone in, because if the goal is set to go to Congress, the whole ball game is over, because then you'll go to the party and how do I raise money? How do I organize? How do I get along? And how do I get on the committee? How do I compromise to be able to promote the cause of liberty? And it's all over. So that shouldn't be the goal. But if you're interested in it and like it, I think supporting candidates, running for office, winning elections. I mean, look, to have Thomas Massie there, I think is just great. And he was somebody that both Rand and I strongly supported before he ran. So I think that's very valuable. But just to run and think that they're going to be, if they're very weak as candidates and they think that they can be a moderate present their case in a moderate way, that's not going to work. The people want to hear the true story. That's why it's very ripe and very open for this message. And when we see the mess coming on, I think that we need to be prepared not only intellectually and politically. I think we have to be prepared in other ways too. And that is why I don't think it's such a bad idea to own a little gold and silver. That seems like a pretty good way to be prepared for what's coming. You know, they've ridiculed me a little bit on TV more than once. But they'd ridicule me when I would come up with this gold and silver thing. What are you talking about? And they say, yeah, but you didn't, they would point me, you didn't invest in the Dow Jones when it was skyrocketing. Look at all that money you could have made. I said, yeah, and look at how many people get lose the money too. I said, yeah, I was rather foolish when I discovered what was going on. The moment of the confirmation of my suspicions occurred on August 15, 1971. And that, of course, is when the Bretton Woods Agreement just disintegrated. So I thought even gold at that time was illegal. I thought, this is the time you buy gold. You start buying. Yeah, I tell them on the television. I said, yeah. I said, I was so foolish then. I was so naive about this gold. I started buying this gold at $35 an ounce. But it was interesting how you bought gold back then. And some of you may remember how you do it, because it was illegal in Russia, Soviet Union. In the United States, you weren't allowed to buy gold. People weren't allowed to own. What was the first thing the tyrants wanted to do in our country? give us an income tax, establish a central bank, get rid of the gold standard, and look at you know what's happened, and so the that means the door is open. When you have the central bank, then the politicians are rewarded. The more they spend and the more they buy the people's votes, the more likely they are to get reelected. And the payment will be some other time. And then they still adapt to the Keynesian theory. Oh, deficits don't matter. They don't matter. Debt isn't bad. And they just keep doing this. But in the 1970s, what we had to do in order to not have to go to jail for buying a gold coin is that you could buy numismatic coins. Well, there weren't that many, and they were a lot more expensive than just regular gold. But guess who came to our rescue? The Mexican government. The Mexican government started minting a numismatic coin, and they backdated it to 1947. It was enough years to be numismatic, so you could go out and buy a bullion coin at a spot price, and we never were fearful that we were going to get arrested, you know, for doing this terrible, terrible thing of owning a gold coin. So that generally, I mean, in reality, and especially in the midst of a financial crisis, I do think that the markets are more powerful than government. They're more powerful than the central bank, and I do believe the Fed is on its way out, not because they're going to pass my legislation to abolish the Fed, but because they will disintegrate, they will self-destruct, and they will become non-functional. The only thing that counts is, how are we going to rebuild? What kind of a monetary system? Are we going to release that to the market to let the market determine it? Are we going to have a strict rule that governments are not allowed to initiate force? They can't do anything that we can't do, which is really what is necessary. But even the war clause, you know, in the Constitution now, and members of Congress still take the oath every year. It's 1945. They've never had a declaration of war, and the people are apathetic. We need to get rid of the apathy, obviously, but I think the opportunity is coming. The opportunity for liberty, the door is going to be wide open for us, and we need to be energized, and everybody in this room needs to get their 100 people lined up soon and get them involved one way or the other. And I love it when the young kids come, and I was fascinated in the presidential campaigns, because in the congressional office, and David probably remembers the parents coming in with young kids for a civics lesson. They bring them in, and this is your congressman, and the kids were like, hey, they weren't interested in a civics lesson. But after the first campaign, the parents were coming in with their kids, but the kids were out in front, dragging the parents in to meet me. And they were really excited, and they'd come in and they'd talk about monetary policy, and they'd talk about the Federal Reserve. And I look at him, I said, how old are you? He said, oh, I'm 14. I said, well, you're way ahead of almost every congressman here. You have a better understanding about monetary policy. So there's a lot of room out there, but you can't get discouraged because it seems overwhelming. No, it's not a numbers game. It's a quality game, a game that we play. And, you know, and somebody argued that, well, we still think that Bernie Sanders has more supporters than you libertarians have. Yeah, but his group doesn't have the quality as our group has. So. It's quality of character and quality of education and understanding. And, you know, we can be critical. I do think that most people are going to be apathetic, but look at it as a positive. We just don't have to worry about them. But get the position out there, and they will not fight if they think it's in their best interest. So they have to be convinced it's in their best interest. So we have to convince people that we don't need to go to war out of their best interest. We don't have to go to war because the left has convinced us and the warmongers have convinced us that we need to be involved out of our best interest. Our best interests are never served by war, unless it's a desperate case for self-defense. which doesn't come very often. And also on economic policy, they're going to have to realize that if you want to take, if you want to protect people from falling, have a safety net and falling through the cracks, well, the only thing that government does is make the cracks bigger. And they keep falling in, and they say, well, we need more cracks, you know, or something. But that's all going to be an opportunity for us. And but I think the number of people that are waking up, very, very many, and I think that is optimistic. I think it's in the American tradition. I think it's a morally correct position. I think that it hasn't been truly tested. I see this as something new and exciting when I look at history. You know, 200-300 years, and somebody said, well, you, Ron, that's pretty idealistic. That's not going to happen this year or next year. No, it isn't. It might take a while, but there's no reason why we can't keep planting the seeds and moving in the direction. But the most important thing is that we can describe what it should be like. Describe what government should be in this advanced stage of civilization. So I think that civilization so far has been detrimental. So one is to challenge the current understanding of the role of government, the size of government, and that has to be challenged. And then we have to be very emphatic that those governments that have us, you know, involved, that we can disengage, get out of it. This is why I think what's happening in Europe is fantastic. You know, it's, you know, let it disintegrate. Let every country go back to its own. I thought, you know, they say a lot of people criticize us for being, you know, defend secession. Well, you mean to say you don't like the secession of Eastern Europe from the Soviet system? That's great secession. You mean you don't like the secession from the United States from the British Empire? No, that's what we want. But we always want the right to secede and leave. And if we have larger associations, they should always be voluntary. But everything should be voluntary, no use of force. I think it solves the problem of immigration, the whole works. You know, we talk about immigration and migration and how difficult it is, and if you don't welcome 20 million people into your country and then tax one group to take care of them, then you're a bigot and you hate people. Well, think of it this way. We can be very open-minded about migration and immigrants. Think of it this way. If there's somebody that knocks on your door or doesn't knock on your door and said, the rules are we can come in here and stay here, and they have a right to it. Well, when they do that to a country, I don't think they have a right to this, to just come in. The worst part is, even especially on the migration thing, people come in and they're, of questionable character, and then you're charged to take care of them. They get thousands and thousands of dollars of bonuses. So the system is not viable. But I think the libertarian position, if you had a libertarian free market economy, you're going to be looking for workers. You're going to want people to come in. But you would have to, it would have to be with the acceptance of a free market system, you know, a freedom to set wages and prices and having sound money and limited government and get rid of about 99% of all the federal regulations there are. And it would be so different in attitude. But most of all, I want to close with this, even though I've already alluded to it, and I think it's the most wonderful thing about liberty, is it brings people together. You know, it doesn't divide us. That is why people who have totally different viewpoints in religion or anything else, and the other people who may be very religious, some people have one idea and definition of marriage, another person has a different definition. And some people have a different definition on what the sign should be on our bathrooms, and somebody else has other. But if you were in strictly libertarian society, you'd just let them do it. But you can't force other people, and you can't use tax money in order to force standards on other people. So with that, I just want to close with the congratulations to the Mises Institute and all of you for coming and all the support you've given us. And that though things look dire and we have a mess in our foreign policy, it's been worse in our history. It's been worse. It's dangerous out there. But once again, I think what our job is to define the goals that we have. You can't just criticize what's going on. You have to say, well, what would it be like? What should the responsibilities be? And is it achievable? And I would say, yes, it is. We need to set the standards, set the goals. And yes, it's an imperfect world. But what the most important thing that we can do to allow this to work is put very, very strict limitations on the power and the control of any and all governments over the people. Liberty is popular. Thank you very much.
Well, thank you so much, Ron and Lou. There's a few people we have to thank before we adjourn. TJ and Ida Goss are here. I know Chris Conan is here. John Bartel is here, and Dr. Michael Keller sitting up front, all of whom made this day possible. We would like to invite all of you who are interested to come on up now and meet Dr. Paul and get a picture if you'd like. I think we'll go this way and perhaps handle a couple questions as you go by. But ladies and gentlemen, thank you so much. We will see you in Lake Jackson or in Houston next year. Thanks for coming.